position. In a bag, I'm useless, but not for long. The future is coming on. I ain't happy, I'm feeling glad I got sunshine. In a bag, I'm useless, but not for long. The future is coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on.
Finally, someone let me out of my cage. Now, time for me is nothing, cause I'm counting no A's. Nah, I couldn't be there. Nah, you shouldn't be scared. I'm good at repairs, and I'm under each snare. Intangible, bet you didn't think, so I command you to panoramic view. Look, I'll make it all manageable. Pick and choose, sit and lose, all you different crews. Chicks and dudes, who you think is really kicking tunes. Picture you getting down in a picture tube, like you lit the fuse. You think it's fictional, mystical, maybe. Spiritual hero who appears in you to clear your view when you're too crazy. Lifeless to those, the definition for what life is. Priceless to you because I put you on the high shit. You like it? Gun smoke, you're righteous with one toke. You're psychic among no possess you with one though.
I'm feeling glad I got sunshine. In a bag, I'm useless. Not for long, the future is coming on. Hey, happy. I'm feeling glad I got sunshine. In a bag, I'm useless. But not for long, the future is coming on. It's coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on.
The essence, the basics, without it you make it. Allow me to make this childlike your nature. Rhythm, you have it or you don't, that's a fallacy. I'm in them, every sprouting tree, every child of peace, every cloud and sea. You see with your eyes, I see destruction and demise, corruption in the skies from this fucking enterprise. Now I'm sucked into your lives through rustle, not in muscles but percussion to provide for me as a guide. Y'all can see me now cause you don't see with your eye, you perceive with your mind, that's the inner. So I'ma stick around with Russ and be a mentor, bust a few rhymes so motherfuckers remember what the thought is. I brought all this so you could survive when law is lawless.
Right,
feeling sensations that you thought was dead. No squealing, remember that it's all in your head.
Hey, it happened. I'm feeling glad I got sunshine. In a bag, I'm useless. Not for long, the future is coming out. Hey, it's coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on. My future is coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on. My future is coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on. My future is coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on. My future is coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on. My future is coming on, it's coming on, it's coming on. My future.
let's get down to it, boppers.
Yeah, buddies, it's the Ron and Fez show. It's Wednesday. Rump day.
Pump day.
Scrump day.
Wines day.
Pump day. Thump day.
Dump day.
Oh.
Dump out your ass.
Oh, jeez. At least that's what science tells us, that every Wednesday you should take a dump. If not, your intestines will die.
Your colon gets impacted, and then it's just downhill from there.
Oh, it's uphill. If up is bad. Because downhill seems like everything's downhill. It's like it's nice.
You think it would be nice, but it isn't.
Well, we got a lot to do today. Oh, gorillas are artists of the day, even though they're cartoons.
There's humans behind them. It's Mr. Damon Albarn.
Well, there's humans behind all cartoons.
But this is a band of humans instead of just voice guys and animators.
I see. Well, do you consider the Archies the original gorillas? Sugar, sugar.
I like the girls better.
That's your opinion. You're welcome to it.
Good.
We're going to do a new thing with Chris Stanley every day. It's smell his drink to make sure he's not drunk. I'm going to have one of the interns get me Maddie and Popcorn in here. I thought we were going to have a new name for Popcorn. I couldn't remember what it was. I like going with Vince Neil. Or we call him Vince Neil of Motley Crue.
Just call him Crew then.
Or Mick Mars. I don't give a fuck.
Is there Go Home Early a nickname? Is that an actual name?
Why do you call him Go Home Early? Or do you want him to go home early?
That's the latest thing now. When I'm sitting in the office after the show.
I've never been up there. Is it nice?
Beautiful view of Times Square. And it's just constantly asking Pips, can I go now?
Here comes Vince Neil. Vince, is this true? You're always asking them to go home early?
I don't think so.
Why would Fez say it if it wasn't true?
I don't know. Maybe that's just his perception. But
Matty Ice is here as well. And does he ask to go home early every day?
I mean, there are days when I'm cleaning the studio alone, but I don't know if he asks or if he's sent home or what happens. I'm not there for that conversation.
Pips, does Vince Neil ask to go home early every day?
It depends on what day and what's going on.
Depends on what day and what day he's here.
Yeah, I guess.
I mean,
yes!
I haven't...
Admit it!
Admit what?
Pips, admit it, that
Why,
it happens.
I don't want you to cyberbully Pips. Pips is just telling the truth. I know that you have this thing with Vince Neil that you two don't always see eye to eye. But you said you liked Fez, right?
Absolutely.
And you said your grandmother's from Dunedin?
Yeah.
Just a couple towns over where...
That's how I knew you guys.
From Fez grew up. And so you wanted to come here and work, and then he gets mad at you every single time, every day just about.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't left early since the time that I was yelled at for it. I've come here and done my work.
You
and,
still
and
was, ask to go every single day, and Pips goes, no, I still need you to do things.
No, I ask him, do you need anything?
That's why you haven't left early, because you've been told you shouldn't.
No, I ask him if he needs anything else.
That's nice. That's good. If I was to say... Chris Stanley, do you need anything? Can I do anything for you?
I'm good, dog.
Then I'm out of here.
All right, peace.
Then fuck this place.
Well, don't go that far.
But see, the thing is, if you don't have work for the kid, why should he be staying?
There is work for the kid, but he's still trying to get out of it.
All right, no
Pips
offense.
Pips always has something for him to do after he says it.
And then I do it. Right? Like, I don't...
Then why
I've,
do we
I've
have
never
to go
been
through
like,
this ordeal of you trying to get why paroled?
Is it, why is it an ordeal... If no one else seems to see it.
Everyone sees it. For some reason, they're intimidated by Vince Neil.
I don't think anyone here is intimidated by him.
I feel since after the vacation, Vince Neil's been getting much better.
All right, there you have it from Chris Stanley. There's something about you, Fez, you won't get off this fucking kid.
Oh, the other day when he came in for the millionth time saying, can I go home now, when there's still the studio to clean up and everything, and I said it out loud then. I said it in the office. I go, this kid cannot wait to get out of this place.
Is it true?
No. I said, is there anything else you need?
Well, that's great.
To which I get a giant moan from Chris Stanley telling me, oh, come on.
What?
Yeah. Yeah, I was like, come on, whoa, everything's cool. I wanted to fuse what I thought was become a weird situation.
And that's why Fez hates you now.
I should not be hated. I'm trying to keep the peace.
All right, Fez, and where you're feeling after this today, I want you to give me a love or hate. First of all, Vince Neil.
I hate Vince Neil.
The real Vince Neil or the intern?
This Vince Neil that's sitting in the studio with. I don't even speak. I'm at my wit's end. I've had it. I'm just done.
I thought your wit ended quite a few years ago. All right, Chris Stanley, love or hate?
Hate.
Okay.
Hate. We all do that.
Hate his unborn children that I'm not allowed to babysit. Hate his sticking up for this unborn child that's interning for.
See, that's what I think it's about.
He's mentor.
Yeah, but you have to know something about Fez. If you say anything good about Fez's enemies, that means you are now Fez's enemy.
Jesus.
Pips.
The enemy of my enemy is my enemy.
No, it would be the friend of my enemy.
All right.
Pips, love or hate?
2 seconds ago, I would have said love. Now I'm saying hate.
Jesus. And what did you base that on?
I guess he does that when he knows it happens every day.
You got to understand something. Most guys aren't weirded out by other guys' little thing. Like, the way that he asks something might be like, hey, dude, do you need anything? Now, to me, that wouldn't bother me. To you, it somehow feels like the kid's trying to get out of work.
Yes, because he has done it so many times before. You would think that's the last question on his mind.
But if he has nothing left to do, he's not just going to stand here.
Yeah, I'm not just going to walk out. Like,
right.
I don't know.
Like usual.
I don't understand what you want me to do.
What do you want from him, Fez? You never say specifically what you want him to do. First of all, have we given the interns over to Chris? And then Chris has given them the Pips, right?
Right.
Then I feel like me and you should stay out of all their business.
All this business happens right behind the back of my head.
But it seems like if Pips is in charge of the interns, let the interns and Pips fucking deal with it. And then if Pips has a problem, he would come to us and say, look, Popcorn's not listening to me. He wants everybody to call him Vince Neil now. It's gotten to be too much.
That got really
weird. I can't fucking deal with it. Then I would step in. But until then, why would I care?
Because it's an annoying thing. You, like you said, you're not up in the office. You don't see this act going on every day.
Why don't you stay down here? Why do you go up to the office? You got telephones here. You got computers here. Why don't you give, and don't take this the wrong way, Fez, the younger people a little room to breathe and do their fucking hip-hop thing.
I'm taking that the wrong way. I'm not leaving my office so Popcorn can have it.
Vince Neil could have your desk.
No,
I don't. You could, though. If you leave,
Is it a shitty desk?
No, I just like to stand.
No one likes to stand.
No one
prefers standing to sitting.
Bullshit.
I'm like a horse. I stand when
okay.
I sleep.
All right, now I'm learning a whole new thing. And that's why I consider a racehorse. This kid's fucking Kentucky Derby, maybe even more, maybe a Triple Crown fucking intern, Fez. And you're trying to turn him in, you're trying to run him down.
I've seen nothing that says thoroughbred to me.
How about thoroughgood? Here's what I want to do, Chris.
Okay.
You're hated by Fez.
Yeah.
Yes.
Finally, it's come out.
Pips is hated.
Yes.
What about Matty Ice?
Love.
Of course, yeah.
Okay.
Matty Ice.
Should Matty Ice now be in charge of Chris and Pips, and then that way he can bring some fucking order to our life?
I would feel more comfortable with that, yes.
You'd feel more comfortable if Matty Ice is in charge of me and Pips.
This is a reflection on the fact that you're a bad executive producer.
Matty Ice is the only one since this conversation started that's told the truth.
You just have a personal problem.
He hasn't said a fucking thing.
And me.
You're just mad because I won't let you fucking look after my imaginary children. That's why. And this is going into my mentorship of the interns. And I love both of them platonically because I have to.
And I have to guide them through this internship.
Here's the
guide thing. This one a little faster to the door.
No, he's here. I'm not giving up on him. I'm not.
Why not just let them do their thing and just feel like you're above it and beyond it?
Their thing.
If they were doing their thing.
That thing. Because you know you need to watch out.
If they were doing their thing.
Popcorn is only about that thing. Go ahead.
The studio gets set up correctly on the days when Matty Ice has to do it all by himself.
That reminds me.
For some reason, when it's a double intern day, there's fuck-ups like the headphones don't work, machines aren't turned on.
That's your problem, Popcorn?
No, not at all. I don't touch the headphones.
See? He's not helping Matty Ice fix the studio.
I see him helping every single day.
What do you want me to do with the headphones?
And the monitor not working?
All right, you guys are in charge of him, and he doesn't know we're supposed to have headphones for the radio show?
You know
this
we have
no, the headphones are there. Matty Ice in charge of Pepper and in charge of Pips.
Matty Ice knows headphones.
So
does fucking Vince Neil.
If the headphones are there, I'm not going to mess with them.
Why would you check them to see if they work before a radio broadcast
started?
How do
I know how to do that? I don't have...
You don't know how to listen?
You do know how to do that.
You don't know how headphones work?
He knows how to do that.
Not if I'm by myself.
If I'm
doing it by myself, how am I supposed to go in there and like turn the mics on and then...
You turn on the monitor in here and listen inside a pair of headphones.
No, you have to turn the mic on. He's right. Vince Neil's right.
No, he's not.
Ding. If he's right, he's right.
He's right.
If he's right, he's
and
right. He,
you're all wrong, and you're trying to give me a heart attack.
Don't get never a heart that, attack never over that. This. Unless it's going to be massive.
Oh, it feels it.
Look, here's the thing. Everybody's doing a fucking great job.
Not Vince Neil.
Vince is really strong. He's just different than Matty, that's all.
Whereas Matty's good, Vince is bad.
He's just different. This is why we wouldn't want you to watch our kids, because you see things in black and white. Either something's terrifically good and it can never be bad, or it's bad and evil and it can never be. Like, if you were his mother, you would be... Your mother. That's how bad you are at looking over people.
If I was his mother, I'd have a bowl of linguine and end it.
Jesus Christ.
Doesn't your mom have some kind of gluten?
Yeah, I'm problem? I'm just going to let it go.
But that did never bring moms into this.
That fucked him up.
You say that it hurt him. His mom has a gluten problem. What the fuck's wrong with you, dude? Why?
Really doesn't hurt me. I'm not the one that's self-loathing, you know?
Who is, Fez?
Yeah. Mm. Like, the only person that would make a comment like that hates themselves. Plain and simple.
Maybe someone who likes pasta would make it.
Dude.
Maybe.
I prefer fettuccine Alfredo.
It's not called fettuccine.
Whatever. You know what I'm talking about.
No.
Cream sauce.
There's nothing called fettuccine Alfredo. Maybe that was your nickname in high school. Seriously, I can't believe the shit you get wrong. Now,
everything?
Fez, can I just say something that's out of bounds here?
Yeah.
You're a fucking adult, and you've worked in this industry a long time, right?
Right.
You can make this about work, and not about this kid's ma.
When he makes up a fake excuse about his mother to leave work, then
he
it
did
becomes
not
about work.
Mention his mom today. This was about headphones. And the next thing, you brought his mom in, who's been ill. Please. Please be a professional with this.
I'll be a professional.
And fettuccine Alfredo. Hey, dude, don't do that. Seriously. That got you upset? By the way, why do you think he's self-loathing?
I don't know.
There's got to be something that you've seen.
I don't know why he is.
You've seen you hurt the kid. You see that he's got some water in his eyes. He's sensitive. And that's a weird thing about you, Fez, because you're sensitive.
I'm sensitive.
I think that you see a sensitive person, and you don't like that sensitivity, and you try to destroy it.
I have nothing to destroy it. All I've done is state facts.
You tried to hurt his feelings, And I think that's because the thing is, you see a lot of yourself in him.
No, I don't see any of that. I know how headphones work.
Here's what scares me. I think you see about fucking 5 inches of yourself in him.
Oh, my God.
And that ain't going to happen. It's, we don't fuck interns.
God.
I heard that from Jeremy. He actually gave me that exact thing. Don't fuck the interns. He called it DFI. I go, the fact that you're now, you know, initializing it means. So, you see yourself, this is like a young Fez Watley?
I don't see that him as a young Fez Watley at all. Not one bit.
I remember when you started in this business and you got sent home on a day that I wasn't there to protect him when I was sick. You know, for being a little too, as a point out to me, I want to say this in a way that doesn't hurt your feelings.
All right.
He talks faggy.
Wow.
And this was even before he invented the Fez Watley name. And I go, oh, no, we're bringing that kid back. And even at first, when I called you, you didn't even want to come back, right?
Right, yeah.
And I see your eyes are watering up just remembering that, right?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Well, the F word gets to me.
I know, but what about, you forget this. I went in and said, hey, this kid's different, but he's good. Let's bring him back. That's what I'm telling you about this kid.
All right, I still haven't seen the difference yet.
Difference in what?
In this kid wanting to get out of here constantly, who I believe is walking around the place high most of the time.
So what? It's a radio station. Even if you are high, this is the place to do it.
I'm always getting fucked up, so don't worry about that.
I'm not getting fucked up.
I am, though.
I wouldn't even play records in the old days unless they give me a little something for the fucking head. How can I fucking, I used to say, how can I listen to any new songs with a clogged fucking noggin? Let's get that taken care of. Let's get the sinuses all finished. I'm sorry, I opened up this album. I don't see any cash in here either. There'd be all kinds of fucking presents falling out.
Shit.
So here's what I'm saying to you. He sees something of himself in you. Unfortunately, I believe that's his penis that he sees.
Yeah, that's pretty unfortunate.
Yeah, you know, because you're straight, right?
Yeah.
Not even bisexual?
No.
I'm just asking.
Last time I checked, no.
Okay.
Go on.
All right, whatever, dude. I'm just asking. That's all. No hate.
Haters gotta hate.
Just love, dog.
So, Fez, if you want to apologize, we can get going today.
Oh, there will be no apology from me. I got nothing to do with this kid. And I don't want to constantly hear behind my head as I'm working at my desk, can I go home now?
I never say those words, ever.
No.
Ever.
No, usually you just go.
What do you care?
It's not fair to Matty Ice.
I never just go. I always ask, is there anything I can do?
That's a bullshit lie. It's happened so many times in the past.
Why do you care? Completely true.
Where I've gone in the office before I decided to wash my hands of you.
When you said you've gone in the office.
Yes.
Do you mean number two?
No.
Sounds that way. Sounds like you're shitting in the office.
I am not shitting in the
Why
office.
Why do you care where the kid goes or stays? I don't care. That would be Pips' fucking problem. If Pips can't handle him, it's Pips' problem. And that'll be, then Pips has to make up for it. But it has nothing to do with me or you.
There's been so many times where I've asked this, where I've said, where's popcorn? And nobody has a clue.
Why do you care where popcorn is? It's Pips's concern. He's here not to assist you or me. He's here to assist Chris and fucking Pips. If I see a way to use those kids on air, I'll bring them in and do it. But off air, that's up to the producers what to do with them. And then if there's something around here not done, I go like this. Chris Stanley, get in here.
Oh, yeah, come in right away.
Yeah, and then I'll give you at ease. Between me and you, what the hell's going on around here? But I would not think I'm going to fucking yell at one of these kids because I don't know what they're supposed to be doing. That's between them and Pips.
I saw him leave today when his mom was sick, and he was in tears when I was outside with him, and he was smoking his pipe. It was...
You still smoking
the pipe? For a pipe smoke.
I moved on.
You didn't stay with it long, did you?
No.
I kind of flaked out.
Oh, popcorn. It looks so good.
Could always bring it back.
Bring him pop smoking back.
When the time is right.
You're never going to bring it back, are you?
No.
I was looking for a smoking jacket for you. So you could look like little Hugh Hefner.
Ugh.
My name for him was going to be Little U.
He fucked it up, though. I mean, there's no more pipe smoking. I guess you could start your tobacco.
We got a fucking spittoon in here for him.
Yeah, it's skull.
You hate it when you see me and Chris get along with them?
I don't understand it one bit. I don't understand why we're talking about the gifts of spittoons and smoking jackets. No one's gotten Matty Ice anything.
Matty Ice got some pizza yesterday. They could barely even finish, by the way.
Yeah. I'm embarrassed about that still.
No offense, but you eat pizza like a bitch. I hope you don't take that wrong.
No, I don't. It wasn't a great showing.
You got a fucking girl belly.
Unbelievable. We got that pizza for you specifically.
Yeah. Well, you get him a present.
I didn't think I was allowed to.
Well, that's because the last time you tried to get fucking tight jockeys for him.
Oh.
And said, try them on.
In front of me.
I didn't know they made ballless jockeys.
Oh.
All right, let's apologize and we'll move on with the show, Fezzy. You're angry, Fez, today, I notice.
I'm wound up. I cannot stand this kid.
What? That is a long leap from he's not doing his work to I can't stand him.
I've just finished.
You're bullying right now, I believe. I believe this is bullying. And I just want to say this to you, Vince Neil. It gets better. Not a lot better.
Oh, okay.
Chances are pretty good you're going to end up in rehab. Just know that. I see it in you.
Thanks.
Of course, I see it in Hicks, still. And that hasn't happened.
No rehab could hold me.
They don't try to hold you. They're there to help.
Well, then there's no way I'm going to fucking stay in one there.
Yeah, it is true. None can hold you. We're going to get into... Well, guy's written a book about Dennis Hopper called Hopper, A Journey into the American Dream. It's available in stores and online. We'll do a Twitter first responders contest at Tom Folsom, author. Folsom is spelled F-O-L-S-O-M. That's author. At Tom Folsom, author. And you can go over to the iBank for this as well. But this is his second time being in, and he always writes about crazy dudes. He did one on the gangster...
Crazy Joe Gallo?
Crazy Joe Gallo, also known as Crazy Joe.
It's pretty cool.
Crazy Joe Gallo was the guy who invented this for the mafia. Hey, we could bring black dudes in. That was his moving civil rights movement. He was the first black dudes. And the other mafias, of course, were very... Fucking mafiosos were very mad at him.
Trailblazer.
And Hopper will actually do this, maybe after getting into some of his great films that he's made over the years.
Hell yeah.
Now, Fez, I notice when you're not fighting, you just sit there quietly. If you don't have a fight going, you're not interested in the show. You either have to be fighting over gay rights, which... I'm just going to ask you, without making a big deal out of it, Do you see this kid, Popcorn, as being anti-gay? Is that behind it?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so that's what this is all about.
Really?
Before the show today, I think I overheard a conversation of you talking about how good the new iBang look is, and basically saying it looks a lot less gay.
Well...
Wasn't that a conversation going on today?
That did come up in the conversation.
Yeah.
Right before the show started?
But
yeah.
As in...
So you're totally anti-gay. I got no time for someone like you.
I have gay friends.
Really?
Yeah.
Why? Are you gay?
No.
Then why do you have gay friends?
Because
he
bisexual?
No, he came out to me when I was 17 and...
You guys were laying together in your bed?
No, it was in school.
Practicing kissing?
Did he touch it? Did he touch it?
No.
Did he just get hard?
No.
Fuck, let's go in another fucking
See how upset he is by it?
Let me just ask this. Do you even have one straight friend?
Yes.
Yeah, it took you a while to think.
Many.
This guy fucking knows gay people.
Yeah.
So you should be fucking nice. He's got something you don't have, gay friends.
I'm not believing that story either.
I don't know what to say.
What's his name, Bruce?
Giovanni.
Made up.
Wow.
How is that? Why would I think of Giovanni?
You don't know how to listen to make your headphones work. Why wouldn't you make up a name like that?
When did that even happen? That didn't even happen.
That has nothing to do with this. Next, you'll be attacking his mom. So you and Giovanni...
The pasta maker.
Please. You and Giovanni, he was standing over your house one night, right?
No.
And you guys were in the tub. What happened?
Actually, it was far from that. It was in school.
In the shower?
I'm over you.
No, there are no... I was 17.
All right.
And he used to sell a lot of gum.
Sure.
I swear, yeah, he was like the gum pusher of the school when Five came out.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, that's fucking great gum.
It's so hard to get.
Dude.
No, I'm just saying.
In
school, that's
a good racket. They don't have fucking vending machines.
Especially if you charge $2 for a $1
pack
of gum.
Damn, Vince Neil, that was one rich gay guy. Yeah.
Was this an economic school?
No.
Just stop it, Fez.
It's a public school.
I used to sell gum in school, too, but instead of gum, it was meth.
Very similar.
I'm going to snort some gum later.
Mm-hmm. Oh. So anyway, you and Giovanni are just sitting around saying how no one understands either one of you, and that girls are gross.
Right, they suck, right?
You're talking about the eye-bang-looking guy.
I don't think that's how it happened, but then again, I was...
Describe it to us.
Like you guys were sharing the same piece of gum, chewing it together. Did he say this? Oh, this gum tastes like my balls, doesn't it?
Yeah, I vaguely remember.
So here's a kid very comfortable talking about gay things, Fez.
He's laughing at gay things.
So we laugh because it's ridiculous.
Yeah, gay gum salesman in the high school? Jesus.
Who wants gum?
Hey, everybody, who wants gum?
I got plenty of gum for anyone who wants some.
Stop fighting. You guys need to chew. So, and why did he tell you that he was gay?
I guess he felt he needed to, because we were like pretty good friends since we were 16. So.
Like Blow Brothers. What's it called? Blood Brothers. Blood Brothers. Yeah.
That's cool.
And what'd you say to him?
I was like, that's cool.
Why don't you say, give me some gum or I'll tell everybody?
I think he was open about it. Once he was out, I mean, like, he started to act a little more.
The opposite of Fez. Like, he was very comfortable with himself.
He was flamboyant.
Right.
Like, he got a lot of cock in high school?
A lot. Yeah, he would, like, talk about it in cooking, and everybody would be like, dude, slow down. Because, you know,
dude, you're disgusting all of us. Please don't talk about being gay.
Don't bring up being gay.
You're really weirding out the homophobes.
Exactly.
People used to say that to him. And
you're saying it now.
That's not what I said at all.
No, it's not, folks.
I just said I was friends with him.
Yeah, that's it.
That's the exact opposite of ridiculing him.
When did he die of AIDS?
Or was it meningitis? He's still terminal.
Wow, an AIDS joke. Very classy.
That's immature, isn't it?
Yeah, that proves you're not a homophobe.
Pips found a picture of Giovanni. And this is for real.
That's sketchy. How did you find that so quick?
Is that really him?
Yeah.
Pips is the internet detective.
How the fuck? And then he has a no hate, and then he's got something over his mouth.
Duct tape, like he's in that
shit. You must have known he was fucking gay since fourth grade.
No, he was like really into like wrestling and like baseball.
Yeah, he was.
No, like
I'm on top.
he was like really like kind of jockish, and then
sure
cockish is what you're fucking talking about, dude.
Jockish in the under 4 feet fucking club.
He's kind of like twinkish, huh? He's like a twink.
He's like a little Eminem lookalike. That's weird that he would find your friend on there, huh?
Yeah, I didn't even give him a last name. That is really Spooky.
Wow. Not a lot of guys have that first name. What's happened with the no hate thing? Is that about gay stuff?
Probably a mix between, you know, not hating homosexuals and just, like, you know, not hating anybody in general.
Well, Fez, I think you owe this kid an apology.
I'm not going to apologize.
Why not?
I have nothing to apologize to that kid for. I'll apologize to Matty Ice that you had to be a one-man intern crew this semester.
That's all right. I'll live.
So,
2 days a week.
Right. That's it. And from there, you know, you see the kid fucking kicks ass and takes names and hangs out with gay kids.
I haven't seen that. What's the tape on his mouth for in case he accidentally eats spaghetti?
Jeez. That's fucking classless.
I mean, it's not classless. It's
self-love.
It's like Dane Cook, you know? He just keeps going to the same joke, and it's not funny.
Dane Cook got dragged into this shit.
Yeah, I know.
It's probably not funny to make up a lie that your mom's dying just to get out of work.
That's not a lie.
It wasn't a lie.
I mean, you want to call up Raritan Bay Medical Center, see if they have,
Oh, yes. Could we get the POST award?
You're fucking awful. How come you're so fast when you're being mean? You fucking say that you're locked up, but when you're putting the boots to a fucking poor kid about his mom dying, you're fucking as fast as a razor. What was that? That kid's too young for Giovanni.
I think it's Giovanni with a child.
Sick. You know what? Call 911. You know what? Call 911 and hold on a second. I want to check a couple things out. And then I'll tell you when to go.
Jesus Christ.
Oh, Giovanni.
Teach his own, right?
Giovanni selling gum. Yeah, da, 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 da.
So this is the gum salesman.
What fucking Guido school did you go to?
It wasn't too just Guido.
But fresh off the fucking boat.
Trident High.
Old Bridge High School.
Boom, 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 boom. Fucking people are in there studying to be bricklayers and
Juicy Fruit Academy.
GF! Well, we got to get into this interview with Tom Folsom about the great Dennis Hopper. We'll be doing a first responders contest on this at Tom Folsom Author. That's at Tom Folsom Author. He wrote a book about just the craziness that is Dennis Hopper, really one of the most creative actors, directors, writers we've ever had. And then offstage, a mad dog, as well as a great photographer, one of the greatest art collectors, like regular guy art collectors you've ever seen in your life. When he died, he had stuff, he had paintings that were worth just tens of millions of dollars that he had bought for chump change.
Christ.
His house eventually looked like an art museum. I'm not even making that up.
Like MoMA?
Like there was no, it looked exactly like MoMA. Put up Dennis Hopper's house. There were no windows so that I guess he could either keep the crooks out or the art collection in. But look, it's like living at MoMA. Keep going through. I don't know how he rested for even a second. Like, that's Julian Schnabel right there that he's sitting in front of. That's millions plus.
Jesus.
Everything that you see in that house. You go to that one picture where it looks like there's a boat or something in his living room. I don't know how you were even supposed to relax in that joint. But the book is Hopper, a Journey into American Dream. It's available in stores and online. The Twitter is at Tom Folsom Author. You can also check that out for first responders. We're doing a contest that's up on the iBang. Let's bring in Mr. Tom Folsom. We'll be right back.
looking for adventure. And whatever comes our way. Yeah, darling, go make it happen. Take the world in a loving embrace. Buy all of the guns and pumps and explode into space. I like smoking lightning. Heavy metal thunder. Racing with the wind. And the feeling that I'm under.
Hopper is a new book by Tom Folsom about the life and times of Dennis Hopper. This is one of those guys, really been around at least as long as I can remember, where everyone loved his craziness.
Absolutely.
Absolutely beloved for being a crazy person. How do some people get away with that?
He's pretty resilient. He's also pretty charming. You know, as much as you want to strangle the guy sometimes, you know, he just comes out with, like, something. He does something outrageous or something terrific. Or he's just, he really knew how to charm people. I mean, the guy was a bona fide movie star.
A real movie star, but at the same time, never that kind of box office draw. You know what I mean? Never a Tom Cruise type movie star. But who doesn't know Dennis Hopper?
No, absolutely. I mean, his generation, I mean, he was no Paul Newman, you know. He wasn't that sort of leading man. But you know what? I mean, this was a guy that was consistently working from his first film when he's 18 years old. It's Rebel Without a Cause with James Dean, you know, all the way up to his death. So the guy, like, he knew how to sort of get under your skin, you know. And everyone remembers that crazy rant from Apocalypse Now or his weird portrayal of Frank Booth in Blue Velvet. But, you know, I mean, you just can't get those performances out of your head. He's a real presence.
The scene with True Romance, him and Christopher Walken, may be the best scene in the history of film. And I think it's going to be one of those things that people are going to be playing in acting classes for as long as, you know, people act.
Well, that's just what Tarantino said. I mean, he said that he imagines that, you know, it put in a time capsule, and 100 years from now, people will still be, you know, just floored at that terrific scene.
But, you know, here's the other thing about Dennis Hopper. And Tom has put this together in the book Hopper, that's available everywhere right now. What he did off screen was every bit as outrageous as what he did on screen.
Yeah, I mean, you look at most actors and, you know, what's in between, you know, these terrific roles. Yeah, so they're probably, you know, I don't know, having some lunches, this, that, the other. I mean, Dennis Hopper was out there living it. I mean, his roller coaster life was just as wild as any of his wildest roles.
Married many times, basically kind of invented that whole underground L.A. Lifestyle, whether it was the movies, riding around with bikers, all that kind of shit. Eventually became this crazy, out of his mind drug addict, and then somehow came back as a Republican later in his life. And while he was doing that, was also a great photographer and a great art director. It's insane when you start to put together his life.
It is. I mean, it's improbably iconic. I mean, this is a guy who's born of all places. He's born in Dodge City, Kansas, at the end of the Dust Bowl. He buys one of the first Andy Warhol soup cans. I mean, he knew Elvis, he knew Orson Welles, and of course, you know, he was really mentored by James Dean. So you put the pieces together. I mean, it's a real American story.
Mm-hmm. And when he, as a film director, and you go through this a little bit. I mean, obviously. There is a film that he did called The Last Movie, which I still have never seen, and yet it was probably a movie that I've discussed with more people, because it's generally thought of, how far can you take film?
It is. I mean, he wanted The Last Movie, and we're talking about his follow-up to Easy Rider, when he could have done anything that he wanted to do. Studios were like, sure, we're going to do the next Dennis Hopper movie in hopes of getting that mega hit of Easy Rider. So he goes to the top of Peru. He literally builds a Wild West set. You know, he flies in his cowboy actor friends, and he, you know, brings horses up the mountain, and he just starts shooting. He wanted to create you know, as crazy as that sounds, he wanted to create the great American art film. I mean, the guy was an artist, mm-hmm. and he really wanted to do this, like, deconstruction of the classic Western, which is something he knew a lot about, because this is a guy, you forget, you know, after he's, you know, he's acting with James Dean, he's 18 years old, he starts doing, like, these cowboy, you know, like, B-cowboy films, mm-hmm. like, from Warner Brothers, so the guy's been around, you know, but he was a real artist, too.
Well, he was in, you know, that's the weird thing about him. He was in John Wayne movies, and then he takes that and goes in the opposite direction. And you could honestly make the thing that he's the guy who made Jack Nicholson a movie star. If Jack Nicholson doesn't do Easy Rider, maybe he never becomes a movie star.
Well, he was waiting for that role that would really let him be Jack Nicholson. I mean, you look at the stuff he did before. He's doing, like, kind of B-movies with Roger Corman.
Right.
And even his acting, he's a little bit wooden. He's stiff. You know, but, like, I talked to some of Dennis's friends, and they were like, you know, they'd worked with Jack before, you know, he became famous. And they were like, if Jack could ever get that role where Jack could really just be Jack Nicholson,
right,
he'd be a mega movie star. And Dennis Hopper gave him that chance in Easy Rider.
When people talk to you about Dennis Hopper, do they remember any of the bad times, or was it all in their mind good times? Because he had to be pretty fucking scary for a long time there.
Yeah, I mean, he was downright dangerous. I mean, the guy was packing, you know, 357 Magnum and kind of blowing it at trees because he thought there was a bear, you know, out in the wild west of Taos, New Mexico during the 1970s. But, you know, I was lucky enough to talk to friends of his, like Peter Fonda, like Dean Stockwell. I mean, part, like you said, a lot of those guys in that underground Hollywood thing. And so they didn't really sugarcoat too much about Dennis's life. I mean, they loved the guy, but this was also, you know, this was a dude who had a lot going on. Man, you know,
have you heard back from some of those kind of people since the book have come out? I've seen that you've got some real raves here from some of the folks who knew him and dug him, but have you heard back from Peter Fonda or anybody?
Well, yeah, well, Dean Stockwell came to my, I did a reading in Taos, New Mexico, like just last week, and so he came, and you know, he was cool. So, you know, I think some of Hopper's friends, the feedback that I've gotten from them is like, you know, if Dennis had actually written the book that he'd been, you know, literally contracted to write throughout his life and never really turned anything in, he said, you know what, it would have been this book.
What, was he really, did he have a contract his entire life?
Oh, absolutely.
To write his life story and never got it done?
It was like a 30-year extended contract in different forms. Yeah.
That's the funny thing about it. Like, he claimed he wrote Easy Rider and not Terry Southern, but then he wasn't really known for putting a lot of stuff down on paper.
Yeah,
was he?
Yeah, that's my major beef with Hopper artistically, is that, you know, but he wanted to be Orson Welles. He wanted to be the guy that directed, that acted, that wrote the whole thing. But you can't deny Terry Southern's influence.
I agree 100%.
Easy Rider.
I agree 100%. And it's funny how they always try to take from the writer, no matter what is happening. You know, people are like, yeah, but we improv that scene. Well, great. Would you have been able to improv it if it hadn't already been written? You know, when you were going to go out and improv the entire movie?
Sure. I mean, there's a difference between improvisation and bringing an improvisational quality to what's on the page.
Right, exactly. So, putting this together, this American life, it's really of Dennis Hopper's. And the book is Hopper, available in stores, online, everywhere. But it's kind of weird how this runs the gamut of rock and roll. Even though that this wasn't a rock and roll guy, as he's coming out doing the Dean movie, it's just about as rock and roll is taking off, one type of rock and roll. And when he's doing Easy Rider, it's another kind of version of rock and roll. It's very strange how he ran along with that entire counterculture.
He was a pop culture savant in terms of, he knew how to recognize it, you know. This is also, you're talking about rock and roll. I mean, this was the guy who, you know, he took found music, as he called it, and he put it into Easy Rider. I mean, Steppenwolf, Jimi Hendrix.
Had this anyone done really that being, before?
No. I mean, you know, the closest thing was like The Graduate, but that was all Simon and Garfunkel, the whole score. Dennis was really the first guy to, like, just take what he found. Sure, he went to, you know, these artists, and they're like, of course you can have my music to put it in your movie. You know, sure, it sounds good to me.
And, you know, he wasn't using even top 40 stuff. So he's got the band in there and all kinds of shit. And you've got to be incredibly hip to pull that off. And then, you know, you brought up that he was, that he had a Warhol soup can. Back in the 1980s, he was the guy who was buying up Basquiat's early on. So you can't be incredibly crazy and then have that kind of eye and have that kind of eye for culture. As he had.
You're right. I mean, this is not, I mean, as much as I wanted to put all those wild, crazy stories about Dennis in the book, and they certainly are in the book, there's something greater than that. And this was a guy who was a real artist. And he had, friends tell me, he just had this terrific eye. He had an amazing eye and used it in his, you know, in his directing, because in fact, he did direct Easy Rider. That, mm-hmm. that was no accident. I mean, that's a Dennis Hopper movie for sure. But it's also that same eye that let him look at, you know, a soup can on a wall, and he's like, you know what, that's the new thing, man. That's American art.
How does... And he's untrained when it comes to that, right? I mean, there wasn't an art school background. Also the same way of any of the photography that I've ever seen him take. Not only is like he's shot some beautiful stuff, but he was always in the right place at the right time. There's some really great stuff in there.
He had access. I mean, he wanted to be where the scene was. I mean, this happens throughout his life. To the point where he's, you know, doing a film about the South Central LA gang scene like 3 years before films like Boys in the Hood come out. Mm-hmm. I mean, people thought that film he did Colors. It was like, well, this is total fiction. There's no gangs in South Central LA. But like Hopper, man, he just wanted to be where the action was, and he wanted to throw himself in there. And that's where his great photos come in the 60s. It's like he had access to like the coolest of the cool of like what was happening in the pop art scene out in LA.
What is about you, though, Tom? What always, last time you were in here, it was the Joey Gallo stuff, the Mad Ones. So what draws you to these type of characters?
Well, yeah, I like the American outlaw because I just think it tells a lot about, they're good mirrors and you know, the American psychoses we have.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and like Hopper was just a guy that, like, he seemed, this is sort of the same thing with Crazy Joe Gallo. I mean, these are guys, they want to be up there on screen living that movie. You know, I think that's really speaks to sort of, you know, the American condition, man. We want to be up there. We want to be the movie stars, not just the movie stars. We want our film, our lives to play out like these terrific movies.
As his life went on, and he found all this stuff behind him, did he go back and make a lot of apologies to different women, different situations, or did he just kind of accept it and move on?
Well, I think, you know, he did do the 12-step program, mm-hmm. and that's part of it. So I'd assume that he did some apologies. But, you know, his friendship with Peter Fonda was really irreparable, to the point where Fonda was tossed out of, you know, Hopper's funeral. He wanted to go and pay his respects. So it didn't always end up, you know, all nice and tied up in a bow once Hopper got, you know, clean and sober. He was still Dennis Hopper.
Right.
He's a volatile guy.
Did he leave instructions, I don't want Fonda here?
Who knows?
Yeah. That's weird. When these guys go and change the world like that, and everybody else gets it, and still they got problems.
It's like they said at the end of the movie, you know, we blew it.
Yeah, we blew it. Which was really, when you go back to that, one of the more phenomenal things about that movie. I think almost without that line, it wouldn't have been such a mind-blowing movie, because everybody thought that they were winning at the time. And again, they were ahead of it to say, we blew it. We had a shot at something.
Yeah.
Hopper, Tom Folsom's newest bio, is out. And you say you got the time to talk to a lot of people about him. What do actors say about Dennis Hopper? Just how good was he?
Well, you have to think about the wealth of Hopper's training. I mean, this was a guy, he came into the studio system at 18 years old. Before then, in his high school years, he was a Shakespearean actor. He was acting professionally at the Old Globe Theater in San Diego, doing Shakespeare. From there, he gets trained in the studio system. I mean, he knows how to ride a horse. He knows how to, like, do all those backlot things that they did with all the kids at Warner Brothers. And then he's sort of, like, really is so inspired by what James Dean's doing, like, this almost, like, anti-Hollywood acting that, you know, he spends, you know, really the rest of his career trying to create that same magic, I think, that Dean did. So what are you left with? I mean, the guy was just, he was an acting machine, you know, and even his silly roles, like something like Speed, mm-hmm. you know, you're talking about a guy who's basically in a room and he's got a, that's his performance. He's on the cell phone. He's in one room. He's got to act out that whole thing. And he totally pulls it off. I mean, that is like an acting tour de force. And it's in all places, it's in Speed.
Right. It's true. And he would take it to that thing, whether he was in a big movie, a small movie, a Hollywood movie. It seemed like it never really mattered to him. The Dean thing held so big over his head, and one of the things I loved about the book is he kind of held it against Paul Newman throughout his life because he felt Paul Newman was getting the roles James Dean would have gotten if he would have lived.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, at one point, Hopper, he's drunk at a party, and he, you know, basically says, I'm a better actor than you, Newman.
Newman gives him the, well, get well soon. What's next for you? Is there, does it take you a while to get over one of these things? Because I guess you've got to, I guess you were hoppered out for a couple of years.
Yeah,
huh?
Some people say I have to go through rehab now that I've, you know, yeah. done the book on Dennis Hopper. But yeah, I got to let this one sort of play its course, and then I'll, you know, regenerate on something new.
But is that what you look for—a new obsession, something to be able to be worth your time?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it just can't be like a wild life. It's got to be. I mean, to me, I like to think kind of broader about it. I mean, like, why is this guy sort of significant? Mm-hmm. And like Hopper, I thought, you know what? When this guy died, you know, his whole death was sort of wrapped up in this huge tabloid divorce. And I think that sort of took the attention away from, and man, look at this guy's life. Mm. I mean, we forget that he directed Easy Rider. Not just that, but, you know, he was this incredible, you know, art collector. And he's this terrific actor. So, you know, I didn't want to, like, pick it up and glorify the guy, but I just thought, man, this guy is like, he's an American Don Quixote out there going for his American dream. And I really wanted to put that story down on the page.
You know, and also whenever I think of anyone who's so far gone on drugs, like where you're almost writing him off, Hopper was worse than anyone you've ever seen. About the time of Apocalypse Now, when he was hearing shit in the trees and all, that if he could come back the way that he did, anyone could come back. You know, anyone who goes all the way out there on drugs and you've given up on them, Hopper's went further. And he came back, and as I brought up at one point, for some reason, he at the end of his life was like a conservative, literally a California conservative. It's hard to believe. So it can happen. The book is amazing, and because, like we talked about, the subject himself is amazing. He never lost his friendship with Jack Nicholson, right? That stayed throughout his
absolutely.
Life.
Absolutely.
And he never lost his place in Hollywood, even though he should have ruined it forever.
I mean, this guy came back, you know, he was blackballed when he was, you know, a 23-year-old kid from the studio system, and he came back roaring with Easy Rider. And everyone, like you said, I mean, it's amazing this guy survived the 70s. I mean, he went all the way with his whole drug addiction to the point where, you know, he tried to blow himself up as a piece of performance art in a stadium in you know, outside of Houston, Texas, you know, and so, and you can see that on YouTube. It's pretty amazing. So, yeah, and he comes back, and he decides to get clean and sober, and like, boom, he gets the role Blue Velvet. Unbelievable. And he kills it.
Well, he does Blue Velvet, but then he also does Hoosiers at the same time.
Yeah.
So he's doing this one. I mean, it's a really great thing to look back at, because Frank Booth is the scariest character you can imagine. Scarier than any CGI monster. And then the role that he plays in Hoosiers, that drunk dad, is just so sad and sweet. And both of those films come out the same year.
Yeah, he literally is filming, you know, he finishes that crazy first scene with Isabella Rossellini in Blue Velvet. Then he's on a plane, and then he walks into this crowded stadium in, you know, Brownsville, Indiana. Mm. And you know, boom, one after the other.
One after the other. All right. It was great to see you again, Tom. I'm glad that you're doing so well and the book's doing terrific. Top 10 on the LA Times already?
Yeah.
That's fantastic. Hopper, it's out. You can check it out at, well, it's available in stores and online. Also, if you want to talk to Tom, it's at Tom Folsom Author on Twitter, at Tom Folsom Author. It's great to see you again, man.
Good to see you, Ron.
And let me know when you're going to be doing the next one.
You got it.
I'm really curious.
Cool.
Not even an idea which direction you're going in or what you're
up
to.
That's sort of top secret.
Yeah.
I'll let you know when I get something on the page.
All right, man. It's good to see you.
Good to see you, too.
See you next time. Thrill.
You got it.
They call the Sandman, tiptoes to my room every night. Just to sprinkle stardust and to whisper, go to sleep, everything is all right. I close my eyes, then I drift away into the magic night. I softly say,
to the Ron and Fez show. More Ron and Fez coming up.
Once upon a time at the foot of a great mountain, there was a town where the people known as the Happy Folk lived. Their very existence a mystery to the rest of the world, obscured as it was by great clouds. Here they played out their peaceful lives in the innocence of the litany of excesses and violence that was growing in the world below. To live in harmony with the spirit of the mountain called Monkey was enough. Then one day, strange folk arrived in town. They came in camouflage, hidden by dark glasses, but no one noticed them. They only saw shadows. You see, without the truth of the eyes, the happy folk were blind.
Falling out of aeroplanes and hiding out in halls, waiting for the sunset to come, people going home. Jump out from behind them and shoot them in the head.
Now everybody dancing, the dance of the dead, the dance of the dead, the dance of the dead.
In time, the strange folk found their way into the higher reaches of the mountain. It was there they found the caves of unimaginable sincerity and beauty. By chance, they stumbled upon the place where all good souls come to rest. The strange folk, they coveted the jewels from these caves above all things, and soon they began to mine the mountain, its rich scene fueling the chaos of their own world. And meanwhile, down in the town, the happy folk slept restlessly, their dreams invaded by shadowy figures digging away at their souls. Every day, people would wake up and stare at the mountain. Why was it bringing darkness into their lives? And as the strange folk mined deeper and deeper into the mountain, holes began to appear, bringing with them a cold and bitter wind that chilled the very soul of the monkey. And for the first time, the happy folk felt fearful, for they knew that soon the monkey would stir from its deep sleep. And then came a sound, distant at first, that grew in a cacophony so immense that it could be heard far out in space. There were no screams. There was no time. The mountain called Monkey had spoken. There was only fire, and then nothing.
Oh, little town of USA, the time has come to see all the things you think you want. But where were you when it all come down on me? Did you call me? No.
That's the great Dennis Hopper with Gorillaz. I think that happened not long before he died, right?
It was like 4 years before he passed away at the Apollo. It's like one of the first times the Gorillaz like performed live.
I thought we weren't supposed to say the Gorillaz. I thought it was just Gorillaz.
Okay, yeah, you could go either way.
I like bands that you're not allowed to say the before their name.
I don't know if it pisses off Damon Albarn. Possibly. He's volatile.
Well, so are you. By the way, first responders, at Tom Folsom, our author, at Tom Folsom, author, talking about the great Dennis Hopper today. And up on the iBang, we put up what we consider some of the definitive movies of Dennis Hopper, that stuff that he's starred in or has directed or wrote. Let me just check with the kids. Do you guys even know Hopper's work that well, being as young as you are?
I know some of it, but not that well. Right.
Now, this is how far Hopper goes back. His first movie was Rebel Without a Cause. He kind of was one of the bad gang that was being mean to James Dean. Also was in Giant with James Dean. And went on from that point to idolize dead James Dean. The way Chris Stanley is done with Mooch.
What?
You know how you kind of idolize Mooch.
He's a friend of mine.
Is he?
Oh, yeah.
Do you idolize him?
No.
Yes, you do.
Wow.
I don't idolize him. Well, you masturbate to him.
Oh, shit.
Yes, and I'm the one willing to admit it of the two
That's
of us.
That's fucking gross, Fez. No one should masturbate to their friends. Good point. If it's a girlfriend. By the way, it's bad fucking taste. If you're going to hang out with a friend and be friends with somebody, when you batch them later, bad taste. So let's go over to this list right now, Chris Stanley, who's and go over some of this and see if the kids have seen it.
Okay. I swear to God, if they haven't.
Well, I mean, they shouldn't have to see everything. So what's first on the list?
Apocalypse Now.
You guys have seen Apocalypse
yes,
Now.
Absolutely.
He was the photographer in that, the crazy-ass photographer.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Do you know this man? What he's thinking right now? It was really a fucking spooky out there thing. And that's when Hopper was pretty out there.
He was totally off the rails, right?
That's when he was at the point where, stop this plane. I know what people are saying. I can read thoughts.
So, I mean, he must didn't have to take much to get into the role then.
You don't want to be on a plane with someone yelling, you don't understand, we're all going to die. I'm more likely to believe that guy than the fucking pilot. All right, what's the next one you got, Chris?
It's a small role, but I felt he was great. He was the father, the drunk father in Rumblefish.
And he was also doing the same kind of thing. Of, your brother's different, man. You don't understand where he's coming from.
He could do anything he wants to do, but wants to do nothing.
No, you've never seen Rumblefish? This is the one that Stuart Copeland did, the soundtrack. I remember bringing it up to you.
Is Rumblefish a sequel to a movie?
No.
Okay, then no. I was thinking of something else.
No, I've never seen it.
What were you thinking of? Jaws?
No. I thought it was a book originally.
Yeah, it was. Oh, that okay. Doesn't make then, it a sequel.
Then I think I have...
It was S.C. Hinton, that girl. She wrote for the girls. Yes. Yeah. So, and by the way, Mickey Rourke was unbelievable in this.
Really good. And there's so many young actors.
Yeah, here, put up this part where he's like explaining like you're not like your brother to him.
His own mother, is she crazy? Is she nuts? And she's okay. I mean, what makes you ask a question like that?
What, she just picked up and left, man?
Yeah, well, Rusty James, every now and then, a person comes along and has a different view of the world than does the usual person. It doesn't make them crazy. I mean... An acute perception, I mean, that doesn't make you crazy.
Could you talk normal?
But however, sometimes it can drive you crazy, acute perception.
I wish you'd talk normal, because I don't understand half the garbage you're saying. You know what I mean?
No. Your mother was not crazy. Neither, contrary to popular belief, is your brother crazy. He's merely miscast the play.
All right, I just forgot. I thought I was watching a movie. I forgot that we're in here doing a show, and we just wanted to play a little clip. I could watch that fucking movie over and over.
It's great.
So, Rumblefish, what's the next one on there, Chris?
David Lynch's Blue Velvet.
Now, you guys have seen Blue Velvet, right?
I have not.
No.
Mommy! Baby wants the fuck! This is one of the craziest films of all time.
Ever.
Yeah.
Hello, baby.
Shut up! It's Daddy, you shithead! Where's my bourbon? Can't you fucking remember anything?
He's nuts. His shit is nuts.
Frank Booth is the scariest, craziest bastard ever.
It's dark.
That might be true.
Spread your legs. Wider. I'll show it to them. Don't you fucking look at me.
When I watch this, I think about an old prom date.
hot.
You guys need to see this film. Look at him now. He's just fucking doing this gas. It's
mystery gas.
Mommy. Oh, mommy. Mommy. Mommy.
Mommy loves you.
Baby wants to fuck. Get ready to fuck! You fuckers, fucker! You fucker! Don't you fucking look at me!
He's riding that fucking gas out, and it ain't easy, dude. That is not an easy fucking trip to be on. All right, what's the next one you got, Chris? This is all up on the iBang and first responders. It's Tom Folsom, author. @TomFolsomAuthor on Twitter.
Next is True Romance.
No, you guys have seen True Romance.
I did, but I haven't seen it in a while.
This is the single greatest scene in the history of film. Period, bar none. Name a better one.
What we got here is a little game of show and tell. You don't want to show me nothing, but you tell me everything. I know you know where they are, so tell me. Before I do some damage, you won't walk away from.
Could I, have one of those Chesterfields now?
Sure.
You got a match? Oh, wait, no, I don't bother, I got one. You're Sicilian, huh?
Sicilian.
You know, I read a lot, especially about things, about history. I find that shit fascinating. Here's a fact, I don't know whether you know or not. Well, Sicilians were spawned by niggers.
Come again?
it's a fact. Yeah. You see, Sicilians have black blood pumping through their hearts. And no, if you don't believe me, you can look it up. Hundreds and hundreds of years ago, the Moors conquered Sicily. And the Moors are niggers. Yeah. See, way back then, Sicilians were like wops from northern Italy. They all had blonde hair and blue eyes. But, then the Moors moved in there and, they changed the whole country. They did so much fucking with Sicilian women, huh? That they changed the whole bloodline forever. That's why blonde hair and blue eyes became black hair and dark skin. You know, it's absolutely amazing to me to think that to this day, hundreds of years later, that Sicilians still carry that nigger gene. Now this... I'm quoting history. It's written. It's a fact. It's written.
I love this guy.
Your ancestors are niggers.
Uh-huh. Hey.
And your great 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 grandmother fucked a nigger.
Oh, yeah.
And she had a half-nigger kid. Now, if that's a fact, tell me, am I lying? Because you your part, eggplant.
All right, this this scene goes on for a long time. All right, what's the next one that you got?
True Grit, the original one.
Very, very small scene, but just the same with John Wayne is great. What's the next one we have after that?
Hoosiers.
Hoosiers is fantastic, and I was just talking with Tom Folsom, same year as he's playing this incredibly cruel, mean Frank Booth, he's playing this sad, pathetic alcoholic who's trying to regain his son's love and trust. And it's a, in kind of a hokey movie, it's a heartbreaking character that he plays in there. And when you're doing that, don't leave yourself out there watching the paint dry. If you're going to be on that fucking picket fence, boys.
Maniacs, you've seen Hoosiers, right?
Yes, I've seen Hoosiers.
Good.
What do you got next?
Easy Rider.
Easy Rider, he actually directed. We'll play a little bit of this because this is how he put his good friend Jack Nicholson over in this movie. And Jack had never really had a starring role and became a movie star basically off this scene. By the end of the scene, he was a movie star.
Carl, thanks a million. Say a little missus for me, will you?
Yes, sir.
All right. Here's the first of the day, fellas. To old D.H. Lawrence. Indians. You know, I must have started off to Mardi Gras 6 or 7 times. Never got further in the state line. Governor of Louisiana gave me this. Madam Tinker Toys, House of Blue Lights, corner of Bourbon and Toulouse, New Orleans, Louisiana. Now this is supposed to be the finest whorehouse in the South. These ain't no pork chops. These are U.S. prime.
I'm citing it.
Oh, I'd like to get over there. How long did you boys say it was going to take you to get down there?
About 2 or 3 days.
2 or 3 days, that right. Boy, I sure wish I was going with you.
Yeah?
You got a helmet? Oh, I've got a helmet. I got a beauty.
If you want to be a bird.
So that's up. What's the name of this six, the clips that we got up?
Dennis Hopper steals the show. Scenes from his great career.
He was great.
That was a sad day when he went.
Does, have you seen all that movies? I noticed that when you're not attacking the kid, you're not involved.
I had seen Blue Velvet a long, long time ago. I had not seen anything else there.
That's weird.
Not even Easy Rider?
No, I mean, I've never seen
classic.
It.
Not even True Romance?
No, I don't think I ever saw True Romance, at least not all the way through.
Apocalypse Now?
No.
Redux?
That's with the Redux. Well, that's with the French house.
Yeah.
Like, why are we adding this?
It's a show, you know, the French were there before the Americans. They lost the MBN Fu.
Yeah, you're right about that.
They fucked it all up.
Well, we all fucked it up.
For first responders, it's at Tom Folsom author, at Tom Folsom, F-O-L-S-O-M author on Twitter.
Are you telling me that these kids have seen more of these movies than you have, Fess?
Yeah.
And you bitch about him, and He's seeing something.
Oh, I don't. I don't believe it when Popcorn says he's seen him.
I only saw Rumblefish in Apocalypse Now, so
that's still one more than him. Well, there's nothing to brag about or lie about, Fizz. You know, why would he lie?
He's talking.
Oh, Fezzy. Fezzy, why are you going to start that?
I don't believe a word out of his mouth.
I thought we got past the fighting and everybody was getting back to stuff. Why don't you do this? Say one good thing that you could say about him. One good thing about Popcorn. That's all I'm asking. One.
Nobody comes up with fake phone calls and excuses better than our Popcorn.
Say one good thing about Chris Stanley.
Wow.
Whoa.
Chris Stanley is loyal. It's misguided loyalty to crappy interns, but I guess he is loyal in some respects.
I take my mentorship seriously, and I'm not going to start attacking these kids who I am supposed to be in charge of.
Now, let's say one good thing about Pips.
Pips, I believe yesterday was able to keep the pizza down.
Say one good thing about Matty Ice.
Matty Ice knows his sports. He's here on time. He's an ace on the phones. Matty Ice is great at setting up the studio. Matty Ice, I believe, is going to have a great future in sports broadcasting.
Mm. All right, so you're mean to all these guys.
Really, Matty Ice gets the best treatment around here.
Out of all the stuff they were saying, that one looked like it hurt you the most, Popcorn. Just knowing that he sees the future for Matty Ice and he doesn't feel.
I wasn't really paying attention to what he was saying.
No, you don't pay attention to anything. Could you run that
back? Oh, man.
No, you don't. That's why you don't know how to turn on stuff in the studio, because you don't pay attention to
shit. Like what? What do I not know how to turn on?
Anytime you've touched these machines, they haven't worked.
That's completely not true. What happened last week? Was there a problem last week?
Yeah, they weren't on.
That's not true.
Once or twice he'll get the cables mixed up, but there's...
I never mix up the cables because it says the names on them.
Thank you, Pop.
How can I mix that up?
Thank you.
As a matter of fact, Fez, I want you to take over something for me. I want you to be in charge of Lappy 5000 before the show.
Okay.
It's up and ready. Because I can't trust anybody else to that now.
I'll do it.
I don't mean in a bad way. You're busy with other stuff, and these guys are busy with stuff. And Fez is always waiting for everybody else. And unfortunately, I'm normally in the elevator at that time. I like to get here really late, and then I like to leave really early. I will guarantee you, if I wanted to go find our office, I'd have to ask these guys to tell me exactly where it is or draw me out one of those maps. If I had to give these kids something, I'd give them each an A. But that'll be... Who does the final thing? You, Chris, or...?
I am the one who has to fill out the final forms and sign my John Hancock.
Oh.
Cock.
Yeah. That's what I went by.
I jizz on the paper.
Don't, dude. Because that has to go back to the school.
I need to wash my hands, then.
Why?
You never need
I
to
touched the paper.
You never need to wash your hands, Popcorn. Ever. Trust me.
All right. Never again.
I think it's all going to work out.
Popcorn, why don't you say something nice about Fez?
I did not know that he was a professional wrestler, so I give him props for that.
Oh, yeah. Well, he was a professional. It was a radio stunt. When you're doing radio shows, they let you do shit all the time. Hicks, let's hear you say something nice about Fez.
About Fez?
Yeah.
Maybe if I had adult children, I'd trust him to watch them. Because they could fend him off. They could fend him off.
Yeah, let me know what time you need me to go down to the rehab center and watch him.
Oh, shit. See, I told you. He's fast when he's mean.
Yep.
Pip, say something nice about Fez.
Fez, you're the only person who can grow a mustache that's lopsided.
Holy shit.
And yet I can grow one.
Maddie, let's hear you say something nice about Fez.
He keeps the show on point.
Ooh.
All right.
That's true.
You got a big future in this business, kid.
And possibly a sexual harassment lawsuit.
By the way, how do you...
How is that sexually harassing someone?
Oh, in the future. It's coming up.
No, yeah. He'd have it. And I'd have to... I hate to say it, Fez. I'd have to swear for him.
What?
You make me uncomfortable the way you look at him. I just wish that you thought that popcorn was bangable. Maybe he'd have an easier time here.
I'm sorry, popcorn. Vince, I mean, Neil.
You've gotten so bad with Maddie that Maddie refuses to bring his girlfriend in.
I'm sorry, Vince Neil isn't hot enough for you, Fez. I apologize.
Fez treats this place like it's the kitty cock club.
I'm going to get headshots and body shots next time in interview intern.
Can you spin around?
I like
for
it
me?
Better when we do girl interns, because then Fez. Well, actually, he did hate our girl interns, too, didn't he?
Yeah.
Dana started a homophobic Facebook page.
So it was cute. And then you hated Staten Island.
Staten Island Anna.
Yeah. Staten Island Anna. And you hated Catholic...
Sam.
Catholic Sam. And then who was the girl a couple years ago?
Crazy redhead girl.
Oh, yeah. He hated crazy redhead girl who went out to California.
And then new girl he hated.
And then new girl.
And new girl, yeah.
We had new girl and new girl.
A lot of girls run through this place.
Well, girls just want to have fun.
Constantly.
Tramps.
Oh, new girl was the redheaded one, right?
Oh, yeah, it's not crazy redhead girls.
Yeah. I wouldn't even permit myself alone in the same room with her.
She was Strong Island.
You had to watch out for her. I'd be like, hey, wait, somebody else come back in. This means you're a witness. I consider everyone else a witness to be around.
Nothing's happened.
Swear. All right, so as we're leaving here, you'd be willing to swear right now that nothing has happened.
Pissed out a body shot of Vince Neil's friend, Giovanni, and he's dressed as Batman.
That's him.
And Fez, you like Batman.
I do like Batman, yes.
He's just in a cape cowl and some tighty whities.
And this is your buddy, right?
Yeah.
Because you don't have a friend that gay.
No, I don't. No.
So, Popcorn's actually beating you at being gay right now.
Yeah, it's, if I was looking for a gum dealer, I guess I would be upset.
Oh, this guy's right up your alley, Fez. Come on.
Yeah, that's a fucking gay thing to do.
He's a mixologist,
You've never been that fucking gay in your life.
I think he's a cockologist.
That's between him and his makers, Mark. He rubbed mud all over his chest and said that he was Batman.
And sexy gay Batman. Which I guess...
I told you I wasn't lying. He's gay.
You're not the one who lies around here, that's for sure.
Oh, that's all he does. If you're getting graded on that for internships, you get tens in that category.
Okay, I'll make sure to bring that up.
Oh,
he wouldn't dare.
I would give the kid this. He fucking stands up to you.
Yeah, because he's a little asshole.
How's he an asshole?
I just think the way that you treat a 21-year-old kid is uncalled for.
I think the way you treat this fucking internship is uncalled for. Oh, when Matty Ice had 6 friends from his school waiting to get the spot that you fucking shit all over.
What spot?
The intern spot you're in.
Oh, I thought you were talking about like an Unmasked thing.
No need for Brainiac.
When did Unmasked come up? Are you high right now? Are you high again?
No.
You want to bring that up to the intern supervisor?
How you think that I don't? You can bring up whatever you want. I don't care.
Yeah, that's exactly
it. I'm going to tell the truth.
You don't care.
No, I do. If I didn't care, when you fired those shots at me, I would have walked out.
That's true.
And I would have told you off. But you want to know why? It's because I have respect, and...
You don't have respect.
Then why haven't I cursed you off?
And then why don't you just let him finish? Go ahead, what were you saying, Popcorn?
I don't even know.
See?
Come on, well, you didn't let him finish. He had respect and something else.
Oh, and weed in his bag.
If you want to go through my bag.
You know, don't ever give up your rights.
This isn't Boston, Vince Neil. This is New York.
We got to get rid of the name Vince Neil. It's too confusing. I like to take it back to popcorn. I think he crossed the line with the kid there. And he was making a point. And quite frankly, Fez, the way that you treat him, I believe, is a reflection back on you.
If it's a reflection back on me that I don't like him, yeah. Nailed
you like
it.
Him. You don't have to like me, but saying that I don't do what I'm supposed to is a blatant lie.
No, it's not.
What have I done wrong?
Have you had one full week where you made it in here on time?
Or didn't try to leave early? Yes. When do I try to leave early?
Every time I'm in the fucking office, you're asking,
That's not true.
I never,
I never even do that. I never do that.
You want to keep yelling at me, asshole?
I never do that.
He's just speak.
I never do that.
You do it all the fucking time.
No, I don't.
Can I tell you something, Fez?
You're not going to step up on me on my show.
Can I tell you something, Fez? You're your mom. This sounds like a mom yelling at a kid. It's crazy talk. Everything that you're saying to this kid is crazy. You don't have to worry about what he does. Somebody else does. This is a good kid.
I don't see it at all.
There's some reason that you don't see it that I think has more to do with yourself. And the way that you're talking to him about stepping up and... How can anyone ever trust you when you do your no bullying thing? You're the big strong guy here. He's the young guy trying to break into this business. It's our job, because this kid wants to be here like this, to show him the great parts of this business. And he's got a lot of talent.
And he's crapped all over it. He didn't appreciate this internship when there was a lot of people lined up to get it.
He did a great job with the drumming thing.
That shit came up twice.
Yeah. That came back again and again.
No, that's all I can contribute.
I give you respect on the way that you're handling yourself right now, where you're not, no offense, Fez, falling down to his shitty, awful level. You're keeping your own dignity.
We're lucky that the pothead's even awake.
What fucking year is this that if someone smokes pot or not, we call them pothead? I mean, you sound like it's 1950.
When you send someone on an errand and they come back high 40 minutes later that should have taken 10 minutes, yeah, it's going to bother me.
What's the errand? What's the errand that he went on?
Oh, he had to run down to the drawing read.
For what?
When I went to get him his medicine.
What medicine?
My shitting medicine.
All right, now you really sound old. Well, look. I want you only to answer to Pips and Hicks. Fez, stay out of the kid's business. He's their intern, not your intern.
I'll answer to anybody who needs, a hand.
I'm telling him how to behave. I'm not telling you how to behave. If he needs something, he goes to Chris for it, and Chris will go to you for it.
Don't you worry, Popcorn.
I'm not worried.
Good.
But, you know, Fez, that day that, I mean, you're bitching about him. The day that he got you that medicine, you hadn't been on the air once. And you're bitching about what he's contributing to the show.
Yeah, I had a legitimate illness. I didn't make something up.
Every day? Every day do you have a legitimate illness?
I have a heart condition, yes.
So do I.
You do not. Another fucking
arrhythmia. Arrhythmia is not a heart condition.
It's a regular heartbeat.
But you don't have shit.
I don't have shit?
Regular.
Okay.
You want to keep repeating me? Yes, you don't have shit.
Come on.
Okay.
Yes, he does.
All right.
Because the emergency test, they just kept getting put off.
All right,
and
how about this?
Phone call has
I got
to
an
be,
idea.
Another phone call drama has to happen in the office.
I got an idea. How about we bring in a cardiologist? We hook me up to an EKG. We'll hook you up to an EKG. We'll see who's lying.
Whoa!
I'd be willing to do that.
Because I could fucking care less if your heart gave out.
Oh.
So I could care less about you.
All right. Come on, guys.
This kid is the worst thing that's ever happened to interns in this entire company.
All right. No, he isn't. We gotta go to break here.
Yeah.
Be right back. It's Ron and Fez.
This is the Ron and Fez Show. On the Opie and Anthony channel. Got that?
Kids with guns, take it over. I won't be long. They mesmerize skeletons. Kids with guns, kids with guns. Easy does it, easy does it. Break on soccer.
Run the face show. Always a weird day with the Run the Face show.
Nonstop.
Hey, we just found out something a couple of minutes ago. We're going to get a big producer come in here. Producer, director, writer. Do I get all the stuff on him? Yeah, there it is. And not the rest, though. How about a little show called The Sopranos that he did? David Chase is going to stop by.
Jesus. Huge.
He's done a show called, what's a movie called Not Fade Away. I think Little Steven worked on the music with him. But it's about Jersey, the, in the 1960s, when rock and roll, well, English rock and roll broke. And everybody went out and started bands. It's called Not Fade Away. Fez, there's a ton of phone calls for you. I don't know whether we have time to go through them. I'll let Daniel just start. Go ahead, Daniel.
Hey, Ron.
Yeah.
I can't stand Grandma Watley, man. I don't like the way she can't disperse to this kid, ragging on him, calling him pothead and shit like that.
He is a pothead.
Who?
Okay, fine. You're a faggot, Fez. You like being called names?
Vince Neil.
Who's Vince Neil?
The apparently that's what we're calling the intern now.
Everyone is angry with you because you're angry.
Well, I'm sorry. All right, then I'll tell you what. Let's send this kid to each and every one of their jobs to intern, and they can all report back in a week later and see how they feel about him.
Fez, you and I had a conversation not too long ago, and I told you have to tell your shrink that you are down to two emotions, fear and anger.
Yeah.
And right now you're angry. You're saying, yeah, like that this is an acceptable thing. You can't always be scared and angry. You got to find some other emotions for yourself. There's no way with your experience in radio, your experience as a communicator, that people should be siding with this kid over you. It's because you go to such extremes rather than pointing things out. You're so pissed off at this kid. Ryan, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, buddies, what's going on? Yo, Fez, remember the St. Paddy's Day show when you took out all that anger you had towards Eastside Dave on intern Freddie? This is exactly what's happening again, except it's a self-hatred. Fuck you, you fucking faggot. Go cry for some lettuce wraps.
Oh, fuck you.
All right, come on. Let's all calm down. Wow. Let's not use the get word.
That's all they have.
You're saying
they're pathetic.
You're saying they, like the audience, is one person. Like you're just seeing them as one person.
They, meaning anyone who's using that word.
Okay. Well, see, they are not going to pick up on what you mean by that. Justin, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Yeah, Fez is yelling at this kid, and he wants him gone. Because he's not doing his job, right? Mm. Well, Fez hasn't done his fucking job in 5 fucking years.
You go do your job, Justin.
I do my job.
I doubt it.
All right, that doesn't make sense. None of this makes a lot of sense. What's the anger about, Fez? It can't possibly be the kid.
Yeah, I just
it can't be the kid.
I can't stand that kid. I can't stand how disrespectful he is. I can't stand how he shits on this internship when there was other people that wanted it.
He's been sleepy.
I can't stand his lies.
Why do you care, though? I'm in here, right? I don't give a shit. He's just a kid. He's cruising through. It's an internship.
I can't stand listening another day to his bullshit stuff up in the office. There's a new rule today. We're not in the office at the same time.
What? Who's making up that rule?
That's me.
Then you'll have to leave the office.
No, I won't.
Fez, he's doing stuff for Pips and Chris.
Barely.
So they don't have to do the shit. Don't focus on him. I don't know what the interns do. I know that if Pips and Chris don't have to do stuff, then that's cool. Unless, you know what?
They won't admit that they have to redo all the stuff he does anyway.
All right, so they're lying too?
Yep.
I'm a liar. Really.
Thank you for admitting it.
No, that was a question, not a statement.
I put a punctuation at the end of it.
What does that mean?
It didn't sound like a question to me. Didn't sound like it had a question mark.
I'm a liar? That's what I just said. That sounds like a question.
When Foggy Otis asks a question, each word itself has a question mark. Each word.
Foggy Otis is the best.
Love Foggy Otis.
He really is the man.
Love you, Foggy Otis. Bob, you're on the Ron Fez show.
Fez, I'm about to ask you a question.
He's walking out now.
He's walking out.
Yeah, I think...
Who's told the most lies in the show, Fez or Popcorn?
Oh, they're both liars. One lies, the other swears to it. It's Fez and Popcorn. I swear, I just had this conversation with him. Like, you can't take things...
That escalated quickly. It got weird.
You know what, Pips? I got to do this thing with Mr. David Chase. But after that, let's try to find out on the tape where it got so nuts.
Okay.
Because it shouldn't have.
You can hear it in his voice. There's that, when his voice goes real nuts, he just takes a different tone. And, you know, it's... He's psychotically for real right now.
He was mad, too, at somebody else who works here. That guy who fucked up Matt's thing. UCB Fred's thing.
Oh, okay.
So he's fucking with Fez on something else. So Fez was on the fucking phone with me last night about it. And I gave Fez the, you're down to two emotions. You're freaked out, locked up, scared, or you're just screaming, scratching like a crazy person. And he's like, yeah, right, right, right. And then it does the same thing today.
Yeah, well.
Even during the commercial, I talked to him about chilling, and he got freaked.
Well, as soon as the first call, he just starts fucking, that's it.
And then he hates the whole audience because of one caller. David Chase, everybody knows The Sopranos and all the other great work. Well, he's got a film coming out to DVD and Blu-ray next Tuesday, April 30th. It's about the 1960s and what happened when the Beatles changed an entire generation. Let's bring in Mr. David Chase. Twilight Zones. Not Fade Away is out on DVD and Blu-ray next Tuesday, April 30th, and David Chase is in studio with us. How are you, sir?
I'm good. How you doing?
I really enjoyed your film and loving the fact of being able to take this step back and look at that one period in the 1960s when everything changed. Did anybody see that coming? Was anybody aware that suddenly this giant wave was about to break?
No. As I recall it, no. No one was aware of it. Just like something's probably coming right now, we're not aware of it.
But I don't know whether we can be surprised like that. Again, when you watch this
culturally,
film...
Culturally, you mean?
Yeah, culturally. Because I think it's like this. If you look back and you see the parents in this film, of how confused they were to suddenly see their children change like that, I don't think parents today, I think they've seen enough not to be surprised no matter what comes along anymore.
Yeah, I think you're right. I could be proven wrong, but I don't think there's any place else to go.
Right.
It feels like it's all been done. And I don't mean that in some kind of a cynical, like, I've seen him come and seen him go. But for one thing, I think the whole concept of hip is over.
It's done, isn't it?
Yeah.
It really is.
Everybody's got tattoos and piercings and, you know.
And whatever happens, the kind of blowback is within seconds now, too. So if something gets, like, if something comes across his hip for even a little bit, in no time at all, it started to be mocked. It's almost like the worst thing you can say about kids today is when they get called hipsters, you know?
Right.
And then exactly. The kids go, I'm not a hipster. They go out of their way.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
Right.
But, and then I think the other thing that happens is if you see people today and then they're 40s, 50s, and 60s and a new album comes out and their kids are listening, they'll put it on and listen to it. They're not going to see it as foreign, or they'll even go, what's this called? Ecstasy? Maybe I'll try it. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
It's not that thing where I think you look back and the parents in this film, they thought life was going to be a certain way. They thought they knew what the rest of their life was going to be like, and everything changed.
I think a lot of what happened was that America's racial thing finally got out of the box.
Mm-hmm.
And because that's where hip always came from.
Right.
It always came from the black part of our society. Up, you know, outward and upward and sideways, but it always came from there. Like whatever a black guy was doing, that's what you want to be doing. You want a stingy brim hat or boots with heels, and I think that the last time that happened, I guess, was with rap,
right?
And that seems to be kind of over now. And I don't see anybody reacting. There's no sense of outrage, or not that there should be.
Right.
But there's no. It's really hard to shock people. I guess
it is hard to shock people. Yeah. I was saying, like, even with kids, I think the best thing you could do is put them in a school where there's a uniform, you know, a dress code, and you have to have your hair a certain way, because then it becomes easy for them to rebel, you know, because you've got to give them the chance to have some rebellion.
I totally agree with you. I raised one child, and, you know, didn't raise her that way. I raised her, you know, always, what's the word I'm calling, validating her feelings.
Right. And that can go a long way. There's, how far can I go before I piss off the folks?
Right, exactly.
What do I have to do to be myself?
Right, because if you validate her feelings, then, or their feelings, then
yeah.
They do X, and you go, oh, you know what, I think I see where you're coming from with that,
right.
Kevin, you know?
They need to get to a certain place where they go, look, I won. I've freaked everybody out, and that feels good. So might as well make that early on. Get
right.
It out of the way
right.
Quick.
Yeah. Good idea.
In this film, a lot of it was based on your experiences growing up. And
yeah, the feelings I had at the time.
The feelings is what this is about, I think, for me too, because you see that when music happens, you don't have to do anything other than experience it yourself, you know? There's a lot of times I think that we don't understand how important the audience plays to everything. So the fact that the Beatles, the Stones, the Who, the Kinks, all those bands had an American audience is what changed the world more than maybe even the music.
How do you mean it changed it more than the music?
Well, because of the somebody had to be there to go, yes, we're ready to do this. So you don't necessarily even have to, if you take the audience out of the picture, who would Springsteen be? And who would Bob Dylan be? At some point, you have to have people that are ready to accept it. And I think that the interesting part of this film is that you saw that the world was somewhat ready to change.
Yeah. Well, I mean, what I tried to portray in the movie, was, which was a surprise to me. I mean, I lived through those times.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't remember that the Beatles were played on American radio only 3 weeks after the death of Kennedy.
It's stunning.
I would have, my recollection of it is, was a year between them or 2 years. Mm-hmm. Or they are, to me, in my mind, they are two different eras. But it was only 3 weeks separation. That's what I tried to put in the movie. And some people said, oh, well this cliche with the Kennedy assassination. But it was a surprise to me that there was only, I mean, the world and America was in a turmoil. And then 3 weeks later come these four guys who kind of remake it.
Yeah. And they look different. They sounded different. And all those kids are watching the same show at the same time, which is another thing that we can't do today. You know, there's another thing that we can't do today is be changed by something. And I think the other interesting thing is to have enough time to let that change sink in. If a band shows up now, you could go on Wikipedia, YouTube, you could find out everything there was to know about them. But when those kids showed up on the Sullivan Show that night, everybody looked at them as if they landed from Mars or something.
That's exactly correct. Yeah. They looked like they came from Mars, but you felt that they came from some other dimension, mm-hmm. some other place, and your curiosity was engaged. Who are they? Like, just pick one, the Rascals, when they appeared on the Sullivan Show.
Right.
Who are they? Why are they wearing those ties, and what is all that about? And there's no way to find out about it. I mean, you couldn't go on Wikipedia. You couldn't, and so it drove your curiosity.
Yeah.
He actually learns from it.
Yeah. I was even telling my kids that there were bands that I never even got to hear. I would like see pictures of them in magazines. It could be like the New York Dolls or Iggy Pop, somebody who didn't get the airplay, where you would go, damn, what the hell? And it might take you forever to find one of those albums.
Yeah, exactly. To find out who they were and where they came from, if you were interested in all that.
Yeah.
Now it's all over the place. It's readily available.
And you can get overly saturated and used to it and move on to the next thing. And then the other interesting thing about that, you know, you had the Beatles coming over, but right after, the Stones, the Animals, the Kinks, your head has to be, you know, just spinning in that part of the 60s.
And they, you know, they sort of, developed or morphed so quickly. Every time a Beatles album came out, it was another thing.
Yeah.
It's a whole new thing. It was a whole next one was a whole new thing. Look what they're doing now. Same goes for the Stones, same goes for Dylan. These are real demarcations. You'd go like, Bob Dylan would change so much within a year. I mean, I don't know the man, but I don't know whether he really changed or not. All I'm saying is what he did and how he looked and how he sounded, in a year's time, it was like a whole other person.
And like you said, civil rights is going on at this time. Vietnam is starting to escalate. So the kids are just trying to figure out that the ground is moving underneath them wherever they're going. It's almost one of those deals where you could say some of the, you know, best of times, worst of times is taking place.
I don't think you can underestimate the effect of the nuclear shadow. And all that. The ground was moving.
Yeah.
And you knew it could move a lot more.
Right.
And I think that affected people a great deal, even those who didn't pay attention to it or maybe didn't even realize it was affecting them. The whole question of human existence was up for grabs. I don't think that had ever happened before. In fact, it hadn't.
No, it hadn't happened before. And, you know, I was just looking at this thing with Richard Feynman, who was one of the people who worked on the bomb. He said that when he came back to New York, he would look at people, you know, building bridges and go, why are they doing, you know, this is going to be done tomorrow. So you've got these kids now, and they're hearing this music, and they feel like they have to live an entire lifetime in a couple of years. They have to get every experience in because the world is going to be gone.
not only that, I think it was a way. I don't want to use the word tranquilize. Obviously, there was a lot of energy. It's called nuclear energy, atomic energy, and in some way, I think rock and roll was trying to either top that or match it, and that nuclear atomic energy is evil and bad and scary, and rock and roll is not. Rock and roll is a blessing and a joy.
So all this, do you think, is going on almost on our subconscious, almost like in the zeitgeist?
Well, for me, I was, as a kid back then, I was always scared of nuclear weapons. I was always worried about it. But I don't think a lot of people were. But I think, I mean, a lot of people were, but I don't think, maybe not to the extent that I was. But it was a strange time. It was very portentous a lot. You know, there were these international crises in which you'd think the whole world, and it wasn't exaggeration to think that the world could, all of us, every human being could be gone by tomorrow.
Right. And you had just lost your president, so, I mean, that had to be almost like the country feels the same way.
But this was even starting before he got shot. But I think all these things were building together.
Yeah. And once that happened, it just has to feel like the writing is on the wall. Mm-hmm. You know, it's all coming down.
And I think the artist began to address that, either directly and indirectly. I think that's what rock and roll music became. It was about those feelings, about, I think it's about mortality. I think as what differentiated rock and roll from pre British invasion and pre Dylan to post, I think is the whole idea of mortality and death and aging and time passing. That was not what that's not what Elvis was singing about.
And you even think like the generation.
Well, he was in a way, I guess. But
the generation break had to do where the kids were furious with the parents for having the bomb, furious with the parents for, you know.
Yes, that's what I was trying to say. I think there was anger about it.
Yeah.
I think there was anger about it. I think we were thinking, what the fuck? What are you telling me? And I'm supposed to go to college?
Right.
Why?
Yeah.
I got to get an A? What are you, out of your mind?
The film is not Fade Away. Comes out on DVD and Blu-ray next Tuesday, April 30th. Some of this, you said, was from your experience, and some of course, is your writing. But you did make the same trip as the kid, the movie, where you left the East Coast and headed out to California.
I did, yeah. I went to film school in California.
And that, again, the country was like a bigger place. When you went to L.A. then, from New York, it was a lot further away than it is now.
Oh, unbelievable. Tremendous. I mean, well, to begin with, there was no JetBlue.
Right.
It cost you a lot of money to get to California, and to come back was almost impossible. Excuse me.
Also cost a lot of money to make a phone call.
It cost a huge amount of money. Yeah. It was hard to find a phone.
Yeah.
Payphone. I mean, you had to have all those payphones. It was really difficult. And you're absolutely right about that. It's a really good point. It was a lot further away, and California was unbelievable at that time. And I remember even up until the 80s, there was something like, I forget, like 10 million people a week were arriving in California or something. California was the real cauldron.
And everybody was heading there. What do you think that had to do with? Why were people suddenly heading west again during those times?
Well, you know, somebody once told me that the short version of American history is the scum floats west.
So if you know, this isn't my hometown. I'm growing up here, but I feel disenfranchised. I feel like I was born in the wrong place.
Well, yeah. Here's what I'm talking about. Is my father's family, there were, I think, 10 or 12 children. I have 10 or 12 aunts and uncles. We're Italian-American. Only one of those people married a Jew. And they went to California. So they were oddballs.
Yeah.
Right?
And if you're going to break from tradition.
Break from tradition. Might as well head out.
Yeah.
Part of a package.
When you wrote this film, did it make you sit back and think about your parents in a different way? Because obviously when you're a kid, you think of them from that point. But now when you're writing this, you're almost the peers of your parents, not the kid in the film.
Did it make me think about... No, I maybe it's kind of like method acting. You sort of just go back there. Obviously, I must have had some more understanding of the father.
Mm-hmm.
But see, I think I even understood him then. I think I even kind of understood him then. But I wouldn't grant him that. But when I was writing it, I was only inhabiting really Douglas's head.
Yeah,
that's in a sense. That's not exactly accurate, but for the most part,
I just felt like I felt for him a lot more than if I would have saw the film when I was younger. You know, I just saw a guy who tried one thing and just for the kids when the world changes, how exciting that is. But when you get to a certain age and the world changes, it just feels like either a lie is going on or you've lived the lie up to that point.
Right. I think maybe for kids today, for a kid watching this movie, might say, well, you didn't do nothing. Right?
Yeah.
So I don't relate to that because he didn't make it.
Right.
And maybe, in fact, you do have to be older to understand that you don't make it.
But not making it is the thing that puts together an interesting resume for a kid. You try to tell them that when they're young, like, go out and fail at some stuff.
Yeah.
Go out and try some stuff. Because there's nothing more interesting than when you meet a guy and he's in his middle ages and he's like, oh, I was a bartender. And
absolutely.
I was on the ships.
Absolutely.
You know?
And you read about movie actors, for example, who were big stars when I was a child. And all those people, like, left home at 14, and they traveled with a circus, and they worked in a gym, and they did that, and they did this, and they did that. You know, they had the most, they just sort of, like, they were, I guess, working-class people who left.
Mm-hmm.
And like everybody in America at that time, worked on the railroad, did whatever came along, worked in a whorehouse, mm-hmm. And people don't have that kind of experience anymore.
Yeah, survival somehow makes you a much more interesting person.
Yeah, and movement.
Yeah, movement is a very big part of it. Take it out there. And particularly for you, I guess, being a writer, every experience shows up again somewhere else, right? Somewhere in your writing, everything that you've done in your life.
I think it was Joan Didion said the great thing about being a writer is nothing gets thrown away.
Nothing at all. It's all still there. You brought up the Rascals. Did you go over and see this?
I did. It was great.
Yeah.
It was really good.
It's a really interesting thing. And, of course, little Steven is the one who kind of brought that back and brought it up. But it's a really interesting thing of one of those bands that maybe not everybody realizes how important they were to American music. But when you stand back and take a look at it, and I think that has to do with this film, is like, almost all the people that are attempting to create art have something to do with the scene, no matter how large it grows.
Well, I was there,
mm-hmm.
and I remember hearing Good Lovin' for the first time and thinking, oh yeah, this song, this is a classic. Of course, it wasn't a classic. It became a classic. But that's how great it was. It was such great American soul music, mm-hmm. white soul music. And I included the Rascals in the movie. But it wasn't until a week ago, and I'm from New Jersey, and the Rascals are from Jersey, and blah, 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 blah. But it wasn't like until a week ago I went to that to Once Upon a Dream on Broadway, and they went through their whole repertoire. And I thought, I forgot. My God, what a band.
Yeah, great band.
And influential.
Influential, and the changes that took place in that band in an extremely short period of time. John Densmore was in here last week, and I went back over the Doors music, and then I had to go, wait, that was 4 years? There was like 7 albums in 4 years? Yeah. Who the hell can pull that off today?
Well, I remember, I believe I'm right about this. It seemed to me at the time that the Beatles and the Stones used to each produce an album for the summer and for around Christmas.
And then they would need singles in between, you know. There were things that were supposed to show up on Sgt. Pepper's that they said, no, we've got to, you know, we've got to put out Penny Lane now, so that won't make the album.
Right.
So Strawberry Fields and Penny Lane would have been on that album, but right. we've got to worry about sales. Because they didn't think it was going to last. All those bands thought, hey, maybe we'll get a year or two out of this.
That's what everybody thought. If you had one, you know, if you're 19 years old, 22 years old, or you're a 50-year-old guy who's managing people who are 19 right. 20 years old, you're thinking, if I get one shot out of these kids, it's going to be great, you know? It'll be a big payday, and we'll be on to the next. Because we're not going to get another one out of them. This wasn't the way it worked. It was called singles for a reason.
I think the beauty of this film, too, and I think, you know, people who want to look back at the 60s, you know, middle-aged people will enjoy this. But I also think that kids are going to enjoy this film for the possibilities. And I think that the character does make some brave, brave choices.
He does. Here's what he doesn't do. I want to clarify what I said before. He doesn't get rich.
Yeah.
In the movie, he does not get rich. But he does make a lot of choices, and he does arrive somewhere.
The film is not Fade Away. It's on DVD and Blu-ray. It's available next Tuesday, April 30th. David Chase, thanks so much for stopping
by,
man. And I hope to see you next time coming through.
Thanks.
We've already said
cool, David Chase.
That was super cool.
We were still bending the ear on music afterwards, And here's the really weird thing. He was like saying to me, he was asking who comes through when I was going over certain bands. He was like, oh, dude, I'd love to have your job, man. I would just love to do this. And I'm like, you're the guy who came up with The Sopranos. Trust me when I tell you, you have a better job. But he was like, do the kids really give a shit about that music? And I'm like, our interns do.
Oh, yeah. They know what they're talking about. And it's they can listen to it. It's all there.
It is all there, but is that they're on the same level as the way it was written? That's the interesting thing. It's like, can your life change from a band that's not of your time?
I think maybe to some people might, or if they're put onto the band by, say, they were an influence to someone they like now, they would go back and listen to that older band. I think almost as homework as to know, not in a bad way, but I want to know why these guys are playing like this. So just to educate themselves.
So you're saying if you listen to the Strokes,
yeah,
and then the Strokes would lead you backwards.
Yeah.
I wonder. I'd ask Matty Ice and Popcorn, but I just don't want there to be any more trouble.
Oh, God. No more. No mas.
Is it cold enough in here? Did we turn down for him?
Yeah.
Or we turned up?
No, we turned down.
We're cold. Down is cold.
Yeah, down is cold.
Hot,
up is,
and heat is up.
Up is hot.
Jesus Christ, how many things did you get signed, Fez? I don't imagine he's a Twitter person, is he?
No.
No.
They'd be doing a Twitter contest right now. I guess we got to give out the other thing too, right? The book? The signed book from earlier?
Yeah. For Mr. Folsom.
Yeah, we'll do that in a little bit. We have crazy times around here. David Chase, very, very cool. He really wanted to be a rock star and ended up doing The Sopranos.
That's kind of being a rock star.
I guess it is, but is it the same? Like, the thing is, if you asked any movie star, if you could be a movie star or a rock star, they would pick rock star.
Johnny Depp,
for just the buzz.
I think wants to be a rock star. I think
who does?
Johnny Depp, I'd say, would give up the acting to be a rock star. Easily.
Kind of is one.
He plays. He pops up every now and then.
I mean, just the way he lives his life. Like the way he dresses and all. That got weird with you and the kid today, dude.
It got very weird, yes.
When are you saying you're shrieking again?
Tomorrow evening.
What? You got so much shit to work out.
I know. I have a lot of things I need to bring up. I may book an extra hour.
Did you want to apologize to that kid?
No, not at all. I see no reason to apologize to him. He's disrespectful. He's an awful intern.
Do you think he's disrespectful, Chris?
I think he might be a little misguided, but I wouldn't say disrespectful.
He's just sleepy, if anything.
Tuckered out.
Been through a lot.
He has long days.
Yeah, he does. He's we ought to get him something, Fez. We ought to buy him a present.
I am not getting him any gifts.
Well, how about just a cake and a party?
No.
Come on, get him a cake.
Well, I'll throw a cake and a party in here the day after he's gone.
That's not fair.
We always do something from the day they leave.
He wants to do it the day after.
Just scheduling.
Can we get pie instead from that place in Brooklyn?
That sounds good. We'll have a big party for Matty Ice.
Don't be that way. Craig, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, what's going on, Ronnie? I know exactly where it all changed between old Dimwit over there and Popcorn, and that was when, as soon as that kid started standing up for himself and not just letting Fez verbally abuse him and bully him, that's when Fez lost it. Like, hey, I'm supposed to be able to pick on you, and you're not allowed to do nothing about it.
There's some truth to that, Fez.
No.
There's some real truth to that.
No, just despising the kid boiled over.
Just send the kid in here for a second. Because I know he's from Jersey, and David Chase was just in here.
He's a big Jersey guy.
Yeah.
He cares so much. That's his home state, man.
Sure. Garden State, isn't it?
That's his garden state.
Well, we got to get back to the card. Who said that? Crosby, Stills, and Nash. Spy and Young. I'm not going to leave them out. See David Chase in here from The Sopranos?
Yes, sir.
Being a Jersey guy, were you a Sopranos guy?
I was a little young for the beginning, but I went back, and my dad's really into it, got me into it.
Well, you have to tell your dad that he was in here today.
Oh, I told him yesterday. He was like, who? And then I had to explain it.
Fez, he's already on your nerves now?
Yeah.
How did he get on your nerves that fast?
I don't know. There's just something about him that rubs me the wrong way.
I'm
worried about him. I got a couple of sets of Sopranos season signed.
Sopranos?
Sopranos season.
You said Sopranos.
That's a pizzeria.
You did say Sopranos.
And I'm just afraid the autographs are going to get smeared.
Oh, boy.
Josh, you're on the Ron Fez show.
Hey, Fez, why are you shitting on Pips and all the interns whenever you went and threw up three times yesterday? Two or three, at least.
That's what I was bringing up. It's fear or anger. There's no joy. And I've said this before. I think that Fez sees a lot of this kid in himself. I think you look over at him, and you see yourself, and that makes you angry.
That would ring true to Popcorn's statement of self-hatred.
Amy Schumer, we're playing her Unmasked on Friday, and you can't go into a subway without seeing naked pictures of Amy Schumer.
Yep.
They've blurred out the naughty bits.
Pop titty.
But you know what's funny? You can see that they're so new that they haven't been defaced yet. So we should probably go down with cameras and document some of the Amy Schumer graffiti. Because, quite frankly, Comedy Central's asking for it.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, there's going to be cocks everywhere. And constant commercials on the television for the show. Constant.
Here's Josh. Josh, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, Ronnie.
Yeah.
Hey, Fez, you know, you're accusing this kid of smoking pot and lying. Do you have any physical proof of this, especially about the smoking pot? That's a dangerous thing.
The whiff off of him, yeah. Yeah,
That's not proof that he's smoking.
You asked what I had, and I gave it to you, Your Honor.
But
not guilty.
Can I just point this out? This is radio, so if he's smoking pot, it's kind of doing show prep.
I can see why he thinks I was smoking pot.
Because I smelled it all over you?
Well, I was smoking the pipe at that time.
Oh, so that's how it happened.
Everything. Full of weed?
No.
What do you care if it was weed or not, Fez? Why would you care?
Because he gets told something to do, and it takes him 40, 45 minutes to do it when it should take 10?
Yeah, because he like required one.
Sending you to the drugstore. How are you forgetting all of this?
Unless
the weed has affected the short-term memory.
No,
quickly.
You're just being vague. That took 15 minutes.
I have told you the story a million times.
No, but what you just said was, what should take him 10 minutes takes 45. I didn't know what you meant by that. That's all I was saying.
Because I just said it a half hour ago.
What's the difference, Fez? Why don't you just re-explain to the kid? You know, he's new at this.
He takes a lot of... you have to explain things
many
times.
Yes, because I have to listen to Chris Stanley in The Office, bitch, because Popcorn, whatever his name is today, can't work a printer.
Sometimes.
And then I have to listen to Chris explode.
What do you mean I can't work a printer?
That's Chris. He's the one who's screaming about it.
Sometimes you print things out and they come out double-sided. But you've gotten better. You've gotten over it.
That happened one time.
It's only once.
And it never happened again.
And what I just say, you got better.
And it never happened again, right?
What I just say, you got
better. It got better.
Just like to those little gay kids, it gets better. Does it hurt your feelings when Fez gets like this, or are you okay with it?
It obviously hurts, because it's like, you know, someone you look up to.
Yeah. Why do you look up to him?
Don't look up to me.
All right, maybe not look up to him, but, you know, like, respect his opinion.
Right, I don't.
And when he talks about, you know, civil rights, I'm on his side 99% of the time. So, like, it's someone that I can relate to, you know?
Because that would touch me if I was you. I'd be really moved by that.
I'm thinking about the other 1% of the time where he's used the other F word on his Twitter account.
Yeah.
That was brought to us.
We've all done that, Fez.
Where earlier we were talking about how he says the new iBang look is a lot less gay.
I didn't say that. Someone asked, does it look a lot less gay? And I...
A lot of people were saying that.
...replied with a yes.
It does look less gay.
Just to move on.
Nice right. And hetero.
That's smart, the way you do that. Just give it a yes. That way you don't have to dilly-dally around it. A lot of stuff up on the iBank today that, we're not going to have time to get to because this has been a crazy day. Fez, not accusing you, Fez, but blowing up like a lunatic. And, you know what, by the way, I feel like I could be friends with David Chase now.
Yeah.
I feel like if he ever does Sopranos 2.
I fully expect it for him to say, hey.
Come on in, Little Sopranos.
Yeah. Also, you know, they all died, right?
I don't know if they did or not. I think they just had onion rings.
No. That weird dude coming out of the bathroom just killed everyone. Probably killed everyone else in the fucking diner, too. And stole fucking Meadow's car.
I hope they didn't rape her.
Oh, no. They raped her dead body.
James, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, Ronnie, how you doing? I just wanted to say something, if I may, to Fez. Fez, as far as this kid is concerned, and I'm not going to get into all the rest of the stuff that these guys have been calling you, I would just like to know if this is a paid position. Is this a paid position that the gentleman is doing?
No, it is not. It's
his own dime.
No, there was a line out the door to get it.
Let me make my point, and then I'll just hang up and I'll let you go off on your rant. The kid is not getting paid. He's a 21-year-old young man who is misguided in whatever way he's misguided, as far as you're concerned. But you're treating him like one of your peers.
True.
You're 50-something years old. You're treating
him
like a piece, you're treating him like a piece of shit on the air in front of millions of people who listen to this radio station. And you're making him look better than you are because you're the big old bully. And he's the young 21-year-old kid who looks up to you.
I haven't bullied one bit. I have just said nothing but the truth about this kid.
Just let me finish, Fez. Just let me finish.
When is that going to be?
Right now. If I was this guy's father, I would come down to that station, wait for you to come out, and I would side-crack your face so hard because you're treating my son like a piece of shit.
Come do it, Grandpa.
Something he ain't getting paid for. That's what I would say. Have a great day, you asshole.
He's his dad is busy cleaning the house out of pasta right now.
Dude, can you stay away from the fact that his mom is allergic and has a gluten problem?
She can't have gluten.
If it was real, I would.
It's real, isn't it? Just even hearing that every time is what gets to you, right?
Not really, because I know it's real. Mm-hmm. I didn't just make up a disease.
Did you imagine if you talked to David Chase this way? He'd fucking sapana you so fast. Oh. I'm trying to put it in a language you can understand. Sapano.
Sapano style.
I hope you didn't say sapanos outside, did you?
No,
would
I
you
didn't
side
say
these
that.
Sapanos? Matt Akron, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, guys, how's it going?
Hey,
I just had a question, and I'm a long-time listener, an observation. Fez, do you realize that the way you talk to this kid is kind of how your mom talked to you? As far as putting you down and everything? Is there any sort of connection there?
That's on the fucking nose, dude. That's your inner voice. The way you talk to this kid is your inner voice, which even your shrink told you was your mom.
Yeah, that's what she said. She said, that is my mother yelling at me.
No, you don't like the way that happens, right? You don't like being yelled at like that, right?
No.
So why don't you break the chain now and treat this kid the way you would have loved to have been treated?
There's no getting through this kid. I've been nice to this kid.
You haven't been.
And this isn't an isolated incident.
You know what? I'm going to ask Popcorn. Do you feel like he's been nice to you? Do you feel like he's been a mentor to you? Has he tried to teach you the business?
No. One time, he was...
Jesus.
Cordial.
Jesus, Fez.
And I thought, you know, we're good now.
Yeah.
But
how's Chris Stanley treat you?
Good. Like I'm his pupil.
Like in his eye?
Yeah, exactly.
Like the apple of his eye. How does Pips treat you?
Good. You know, he's not like...
Not like Chris.
Yeah. Not like a student teacher, but right. Like he's...
He's like a student teacher.
He's like the assistant. He's like the assistant principal, you know?
And how do I treat you? Am I like a dean?
You're like the mayor. or the superintendent.
Okay, I'm the superintendent of schools.
Yeah.
And I'm like, looks like we're going to have to put a new wing in here.
Superintendent's coming around, guys. Fucking clean this place up.
Skinner! So everybody has this place for him, Fez, and then you won't join in with this.
I don't want a place with him now.
You realize that last night I'm on the phone with you talking to you about some of the problems that you have with people in this place.
Right, yeah.
And I said you don't seem to be making any allies in the halls. This could be practice for you on how to treat a human being.
I see him making allies in the halls.
Like with who?
I don't know their names specifically, but...
Well,
like,
nobody in power. There's no one in power. That
I wouldn't know, because yeah. I don't know them, so I don't know if they're in power.
Well,
but
you complained that you had nobody in power that would help you with some of your stuff.
Right, yeah. That.
But, you know, the way you treat people can be practiced all the time.
I have no reason to treat this kid any other way than I did today. I have no reason to.
Of course you have a reason to, because he's a human being and because he's not fully done yet. You can look at him with understanding. You don't... That would be the reason. To rise above it. You could find the Desmond Tutu in yourself. You could find the Mother Teresa in yourself. You can find the... And I'm going to say it. Alan Alda in yourself.
Beautiful.
Kareem, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Ronnie B, you sound like a million bucks. Just wanted to call and say that please, we're going to start a Fire Fez Watley posse. This is getting ridiculous. I mean, I've been watching, listening to the show since I was a kid, and this is just, I mean, now it's becoming the advice show every hour now, almost every day.
The advice show.
I did just have a very interesting conversation with David Chase.
There was no advice given nor received there.
Where he basically said, I want your life. He actually said this to me. I want to live your life. And we were like doing like Friday Night Lights, but from a whole different mind fuck place.
Like a Jersey fucking gangster place?
No. Mm-hmm.
All right, well, I totally got that wrong. Then.
Like an Earth 2. Yeah, you get a lot of stuff wrong.
Yeah, constantly, actually.
Man, I'm fucking hot in here. It's too hot.
It's
cranked now.
Drop that shit as low as it could.
I mean, seriously, it's like... I looked under because I thought a midget was lighting my balls on fire.
Oh, that's painful.
Sorry, that's me.
That's a metaphor I was trying to make for everybody. Kevin, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, buddy.
Yeah.
But, you know, Popcorn, he hangs up on me when he's screening the phone, so I really don't care for him all that much, but that's all right.
Yeah.
But I think it's pretty unfucking believable that Fez will sit there and get so goddamn worked up over the dumbest shit. But it sounds just like the day that he got drunk in studio and was throwing pizza at that poor kid. You're a fucking asshole, Fez.
Worked up about the dumb shit. You mean like this call?
Go fuck yourself, faggot. How do you like
see,
that?
I wanted to say, how long could you
like
go
that?
Without going caveman?
How
Neanderthal.
Like
he's got nothing.
Like fucking ass.
Man, I'm reading a couple, people writing stuff up on the playlist, and there's 243 comments on there.
Whew.
And I would think, oh man, they really like gorillas today.
You're right.
No. Stuff like Fez and Popcorn should just both cry together and then eat each other's assholes out.
I don't know about the second part, but the first part might be therapeutic.
Fez loves making pasta jokes. And there's one from Luke, Fez. Fez is everything that he hates. A kid bullying old cunt. You're your mom now, dude. You're your mom. Here's Chris, you're on the Run of Fez show.
Hey, Fez, you call this kid a liar, and how's Skippy doing?
Oh, yeah.
And also, you're worried about him using the other F word, yet what about, he used to use it all the time before you were gay.
Constantly.
Yeah, and
down to the point where I got uncomfortable with it.
Oh, wow, it must be a lot.
Yeah. Go ahead, Fez.
Yeah, it's I've changed my mind on the word, and the kid's not going to win me over by using it.
I didn't ever heard this kid say it.
Yeah, it was brought to us from his Twitter account.
He said gay.
No, he used the F word.
In what context? I don't even remember this.
It was something along the line of UFs. I don't know who he was talking to.
What do you think is the worst word? F word or N word?
F word.
N word's worse.
And then together?
That's just fucking fun.
That makes me miss Earl. Brian, you're on the Run of Fez show.
Fez, why do you only choose easy targets? And why don't you call out Ron when Ron does the exact same thing to you?
True. I tell him all the time. And I tell him all the time, I go, Fez, you can be mad at me. And he acts like he never is.
I don't remember Ron making up a story about a fake court case or a fake mom illness. I don't remember any of that.
Most of my stories are pretty fake.
I have the court dates in my book bag.
You don't have to. All right, we're not cops. If you smoke pot before you come here or lie, whatever, we get it. It's radio.
No, I'll take a drug test too.
You don't have to.
No, I'll buy it, bring it in. I don't know.
With whose piss?
Fez, whoever's clean at the time.
Don't take mine.
Fez, could you just give a little bit to the kid and then we can move on?
I am not. I'm giving nothing to this kid. Zero.
Zilch. Nada. Andre, you're on the Run of Fez show.
Hey, Ronnie. I just wanted to tell you how much I commend you for coming in every day, day after day, like pretty much by yourself, not having a partner. Like, it's just awesome, dude. You entertain us all every day, and you're pretty much on your lonesome. You're amazing, buddy. Have a good one.
The thing is, I do always have popcorn.
Not always.
I got a new nickname for you, too, Popcorn.
Let me hear it.
Sleepy sleep, the Z fuck.
Does who fuck?
The Z fuck. Like it was a bunch of Z's.
Oh,
you know what?
Oh, okay.
I haven't told you guys this because I don't want to get them in any heat.
Yeah.
But during the Alan Alda arrest, everybody in the room is laughing. And when they're not laughing, they're just sitting on the end of their chair because Alan Alda is dynamic and. I'm going to give away a thing. I basically said at the end of it, if you live your life like Alan Alda, you've lived a good life. That this is a person that we should all model. Because here he is in his 70s and still going out to learn things.
And each movie he's in, he's brilliant.
You fell asleep during that.
What the fuck?
I didn't
fuck?
Fall asleep.
Your eyes were closed.
God.
No, I had a headache and I was slouched down. I was doing
with your eyes closed.
I know. I was paying attention.
He fucking fell asleep in this thing.
Yeah, you. Well,
I was awake.
Oh, well,
I was awake.
Maybe you were awake, but you were slouched down with your eyes closed for a long period of time.
No, I had my eyes closed
right
once
now?
In a while.
Is that why you dozed off? Is that why you got the nods during an unmasked?
No.
All right, Fez. Do you see the level of anger that I have?
Yeah.
That's the appropriate level. not where you are.
Then I'm ready to go inappropriate, because that's ridiculous. That's inappropriate to fall asleep in something where we had so many people wanting to be part of that audience. This kid gets in because he's on the inside, and then that's how he treats his spot?
He got in because Otto canceled. At the last second, right?
Yeah, like hours.
Yeah. Apparently George was ill.
Yeah.
So.
Came down with something.
So everyone who's lined up on the phones to defend this kid, guess what? He's asleep. He's asleep during Unmasked with Alan Alda.
I was not asleep.
Well, he was laying with his eyes closed.
Resting your eyes?
No, I had him closed once in a while.
He used his sweatshirt as a pillow.
Okay. That is not true.
All right, so he wasn't asleep. He was laying back with his eyes closed.
That's what we call asleep.
I guess you had a headache.
I did, but you heard, if you listen to the recording, you can hear me laughing, and like I was clapping. Like,
all right, I'm going to listen for that.
I'm going to listen for that individual clap.
I want you to break it down like the movie Blowout until you can find it.
No, don't isolate my laugh. It's stupid.
Nick, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
What's up, buddy? Fezzi, how come you didn't confront David Chase when David Chase had Vito killed just because he was gay?
I wasn't in here with David Chase.
But you had him sign stuff, so obviously you don't have a problem with him personally.
So you would have. If you were in here, you would have given him shit about it.
I understand. He also showed Vito in a relationship with Johnny Hotcakes.
How'd that end?
But Vito was wearing that stupid hat and at the leather bars.
I'm a big fan back to the .com days. I'm not defending this kid at all. But you do pick prey on the weak.
You take prey on the weak, Fezzi.
Or do I do it on the ones that deserve it, the people who fall asleep while they get a chance to go to Unmasked?
No, I wish I didn't even say it to you. I wish I would have said it privately to him. Your anger is inappropriate.
I don't think it's inappropriate in this case.
Your level of anger is inappropriate. I'm just trying to show you how the world works. You wouldn't have people as mad as you if you didn't go way up there and were swinging from the chandeliers. And look, let's face it. You weren't angry that I said that he was asleep. You were ecstatic. You were thrilled to know and try to use him back against the callers.
It's just proof of what a fuck-up he is.
He's not a fuck-up. He had a headache. And that I know.
The eyes haven't closed due to the migraine in here since he's walked back in.
Dude, your hands are freezing. You all right?
What's wrong?
What's wrong?
No, nothing. I don't.
Why are you crying now?
No, I'm not. It's just the lights are right there.
Why are you saying?
Oh, yeah, the headache's
back
now.
Be honest with us. There's something bothering you.
Please quit moving the mics around. We get complaints about that.
I didn't know we got complaints. Who's complaining?
They can be very noisy.
So you pay attention to those complaints and not all the other complaints. Those are just asshole listeners. Craig, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, Ron. Thanks for taking my call. Hey, Fez, you're not going to bait me into using the F word on you because then you win. But I know some gay guys, and they're all happy. And you seem really miserable, and you have a pretty good life, I would think. And the three things, Ron, I'd hate to correct you, you said that he's either angry or in fear, but you did forget tears. And I won't use the F word, but is cocksucker wannabe available?
You're right, win.
I actually put his fear and sadness together. Maybe that deserves a third. Maybe you're either fearful, sad, or angry. I say you just wipe your eyes. What's going on, Popcorn? Be open with us here.
No, there's nothing to be open about.
Be real.
I am.
But what just had you wiping your eyes like that?
Mitchie.
Why can't you be honest?
I swear.
I'm being honest. I'm uncomfortable in this situation.
As am I.
What makes you so uncomfortable?
I mean, we're all in the same room.
I don't know. The situation.
He's a great kid, Fez. I really like him.
Maybe that's when he's awake.
Hmm. Dale, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Yeah, Fezzy, listen, you sound a little angry. How about I come down there and maybe I suck your dick, maybe you'll reach around, maybe a little anal action. Take the edge off. What do you say, buddy?
Sounds good. Leave your email address.
Okay, faggot. Bye.
Oh, jeez.
Whoa.
I win again.
It's a setup.
Whoa. You should have said no.
Yeah, I would have said no.
He wouldn't have said the other F word then.
No, you're really crying. You
no,
keep saying that you're not.
No, wiping my nose.
Why do you got to be that way?
Honestly.
You can admit
all
it.
You got to do is admit it. We're here being honest. It's an honest time for all of us.
I'm really not.
Why is he saying that?
I don't know.
He's sitting there wiping big tears out of his eyes.
No, I'm not.
You know, Fez, sometimes I feel like you pick on the week like the New York Knicks did with the Boston Celtics. Did you even watch that game last night?
I caught the second half where everything fell apart for the Celtics.
I think a lot that helped is that Spike Lee is dressed like a maniac fucking clown.
He could feel it. Spike Lee could feel it.
Matt, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
You know, I think Fez really kind of enjoys putting some people down. He's not going to put Ron down. He's not going to put Hicks down. He's not going to put anybody down. I got to tell you, Fez, if I was that kid, I'd walk over there and split your fucking head open.
Some way to
click.
Do you feel like you want to split his head open?
No.
Just take a fucking hammer.
You need a nap first?
Fez.
I changed my answer. Yes.
My head's right here.
What's that mean? You ready to throw down, Fez?
I don't think he could do it.
So that's
I don't want to do it.
So the only physical fights that you would ever want to be in is the ones that you would win?
I think that goes for everybody.
Really?
I concur.
You don't think a lot of people would be in fights knowing that they couldn't win, but figuring it would be better? You know, everyone isn't out just to bully people or pick on people. There's some people who fight because they deem it to be right.
I don't think it's
bullying. There are a lot
of
people that would run in and fight a bully just to get them to stop picking on another person. But I guess if you're just thinking of it as another notch in the belt, then yeah, you are right. It does make sense that when you fight, pick on a smaller person. Mark, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hi, Ron. How you doing? This is Mark in New Jersey. I just can't believe, you know, I called up to call Fez that word that he doesn't like to hear, but, you know, it sounds like a total work, especially once you said he fell asleep.
No, his kid's fucking eyes were shut, and he knows it.
I just found out about it because I was sitting in front of him.
I will admit my eyes were shut a couple times.
I don't know. But, you know, you are a fag, and that's the way it is. And, Ron, I love you. Hicks, you're the best. And popcorn, you know, whatever.
Shh, you'll wake him.
For the record, calling someone a fag is not the way to go. If you know.
This is what Bad Hat Harry says. I used to think that Ron was always in control. I never thought that he would take a back seat to the insane rantings of a sick, sick Fez. Ron, you want to save somebody? Save yourself. Jason, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, buddies, I was just going to say, Fez, you wouldn't pass the drug test either. I don't think there's anybody in that room other than Ron that probably passed one. I still think I got
residuals. To this day, I wouldn't take a fucking drug test.
Those things are fucking...
I don't like the idea of it.
It's bullshit.
Thank you. I don't know if I even want to go to these phones. They're all saying the same things. I feel like we're getting redundant. I feel like we get into these ruts, these anger ruts. I'm just going to keep hearing the get word.
People seem pretty happy with it. Saying that word.
You got to see the rocket test up on the iBank today. That's amazing.
SpaceX.
I never saw anything like that before in my life.
That's wild. Those guys are really fucking running shit right now.
I don't know what the Don't Kiss the Fox reporter is. Redneck Games is up there. That's all on the iBank viral videos. I go to that a lot now, or I'll just watch little viral videos.
Hell yeah. Just go on my videos.
Florida looking to end lifelong alimony. Florida's always at the cutting edge. Ron Paul's mad at his son, Rand Paul, for now being pro-drones.
Yeah, his people fucking lost their shit. They went totally nuts after hearing him go on about saying drones can... Yeah, it's fine. Use them in America.
I'd like to be at that thing and go, what are you droning on about? And then try to fucking put up a hi-fi for everybody. Nick, you're on the Run of Fez show. Nicky.
Hey, Ron, I just wanted to call and thank Hicks for all the bullshit he's got to put up with. I mean, you're at least collecting the check. I mean, Hicks just kind of sits there. He's not really getting paid much. Hey, Hicks, want to go fish this summer? Drop some molly, bro?
Yeah, sure. I'll fucking do some molly at a fish show.
All right, see you down Walthall. Peace, boys.
All right.
Peace. Can I just ask you one question, Fez?
Sure.
If this was a gay kid... And you heard somebody screaming at him and bringing up his mom and stuff like that. Would you think that it was bullying?
And it's all the same circumstances, except he's gay in this case.
Mm-hmm.
No, I wouldn't think it was bullying.
And yet I've never seen you once go against a gay person. I don't believe you. I don't believe you.
Nope. I would be just as upset at a gay kid who fell asleep during a show.
Don, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, Ron. You know, I've been listening to the show for years, and I used to think that it was just, you know, a bit. Nah, it was funny. But, you know, Fez, you're a disgusting hypocrite. Every single thing that you sit there and you hate about what other people do, you do to this kid, and it's just disgusting, man.
I loved you when you fought Hogan in WrestleMania 3.
That's the best you've got? 30 years in radio, and that's the best you've got. I'll give you a couple.
All you had was I'm disgusting.
It's the best he's had in a long, long time.
Well, true, Ron. You're right on that one.
No, check in with everyone in Grenoble, France. I bet they dug it.
I thought it was pretty good.
Andre's probably no more for being on a t-shirt than his actual wrestling career at this point.
Dr. Steve said he's in on the EKG challenge. What exactly were we saying you wanted to do with the EKG challenge?
Hook it up, see who's lying.
Or
to see if I'm lying.
Your thing about your heart was what?
Arrhythmia. A regular heartbeat. Mm-hmm. It skipped a beat. Or, like...
All right, show us how, because you're a drummer, you can do this. Show us what a heart is supposed to sound like, and then show us what your heart sounds
like. Okay, a normal heart would sound like... I guess, and mine kind of sounds like...
Wow, Fez, you got to be fucking gentle with this kid.
Wow, your heart's stopping that much.
Well, it's just a skip. Skip of a beat. All right, give us the normal one and keep it going a while. Children behave. That's what they say when we're together. Anyway, the point is this. His heart, I think, is worse than yours, Fez.
I don't think so.
No, I don't. I haven't had any procedures, so.
You worry about it, though? scared that it'll happen to you one day?
Yeah, big time.
Like it'll just stop?
No, it's at, I'm more at risk for, like, stroke and heart attack. So...
Same thing, because you'll just...
Stroke is the worst, though.
Massive stroke.
Stroke is like being asked to be given brain damage.
And like your right side just doesn't work anymore.
Yeah, but exactly.
Sometimes it's worse because like the right side of your brain doesn't work, so you don't remember a lot of things, who people are and stuff.
And that's what Popcorn has over hanging over his head.
Yeah, you could end up repeating things over and over.
I mean, not for a while.
Yeah, hopefully. But you could end up repeating things over and over.
Not for a while, hopefully.
Yeah, but you could end up repeating things over and over.
Not for a while, hopefully.
Yeah, but you could end up repeating things over and over.
Not for a while, hopefully.
Oh Fez, God. What was it like for you to see the kid riffing with me? Isn't that like seeing a young Fez Watley the way he used to be?
No.
When's the last time you riffed?
I think when I was going off on the Andre the Giant caller.
No, with me as part of the thing. Not just off alone... doing, you know, wrestling put-downs, but actually riffing.
It's
like what you see Chris doing. You see the kid today, right? Why wouldn't you say to him, hey, way to go with a bit. You're doing it, dude.
I guess I was just shocked that he was awake.
Nick, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, what's going on?
Yeah.
I've got a question for Fez. How can he be so upset with Popcorn for looking like he maybe was sleeping when there's been days when you don't even know he's on the show? I mean, you need more dead air than you know what to do with.
Don't you think it's a little rude to do that to a guest?
You're doing it to how many people when you're on the radio?
Don't you think it's a little rude and disrespectful to do that to the amount of people that really wanted to be in that studio today?
I totally see your point.
And to shit on that?
No, I do see your point. I do, but I think it's, you know, you're being a little hard on the kid, being that you do it almost every day.
I don't fall asleep in front of Alan Alda every day.
No, not Alan Alda, but you leave us hanging, the listeners. Poor Ronnie over there.
I'm telling you what, you asked me why I would be upset about him sleeping during an interview. And I explained it.
Do you feel more power today that you're being mean to this kid than you do on a sad day? Or what if I just bring up another topic outside of this? Do you think that you would jump in with the same amount of energy?
I'm not sure. I may get nervous.
So what's the difference? Why can't you talk about things that are in the news or things that, you know, people are curious about? Why is it only when you're beating up on an intern do you feel alive?
This kid just pushes a wrong button in me.
So you realize that this is wrong, what you've done today.
It's for anyone to get this upset and blow their stack, it's probably not healthy for anyone to do that.
Then why are you getting mad at the callers?
Their love of the other F word?
Dean, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, Ron, hey, for your cardiac conundrum, why don't you go down the hallway to the AED and see which one gets shocked?
Might be a fun idea.
Guess we needed one during the Unmasked.
I wish I didn't bring it up, because it just gets thrown back over and over and over again. Tommy, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, Ronnie, how's it going, buddy?
Tommy?
Hey. Oh, yeah. I'm getting Tommy. Yay.
Tommy? Tommy?
Hey,
yay!
Tommy?
Whackbag! Whackbag! Whackbag!
Tommy?
I miss these days. I love you, Ron.
Tommy? Tommy, can you hear me? See me. Bo, Toronto, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, how's it going?
What can we do for you, buddy?
Just wanted to say, people are ripping on Fez, and I just wanted to tell Popcorn that in this entertainment industry, people are dicks. Fez is a dick, and you just got to suck it up. And kind of on that point, he gets so offended by a word, that the other F word. It has more to do with inflection and context. For example, if I were to say, yeah, Fez is okay, but he's a bit of a fag. Not too offensive. But if I were to say,
Very.
Fez, you're a faggot. That's offensive. You just got to take it in stride, Fez, and popcorn. Take it easy, dude.
You're insane. It's offensive every way.
I always tell people you need a thin skin in this business.
Don't you mean thick?
Mm-mm.
Okay. Thin.
Really just like a membrane. That's easily...
Just popular. Clarifying.
Yeah.
Interesting.
As few as you... yeah, just let everything get to you. That's always been my motto.
That's...
I also say this, drink before work.
Gotcha. Done and done.
Never checked on it, though?
No, I did. I'm just saying, updating.
Well, give me a, you know... Awful. Do-do-do. Here's Joe. Joe, you're on the Ron Fez Show.
Hey, what's up, guys? Fez, you contend that you're not bullying this kid because what you say is true. Well, is it bullying when people call a gay kid gay or a fat kid fat?
I think it's bullying if you call a fat kid gay.
Kid just likes cheeseburgers.
I
that's
and I know you can't call a gay kid fat. He'll really fucking freak out.
That's true. Shut up.
That's a good impression, though.
Shut up.
Cindy, you're on the Ron Fez Show.
Hey, Cindy, you're really pissing me off.
How's that?
Just like you're being just like your mom. It's like your mom came to work instead of Fez. Your mom, you know, the whole problem...
Rip Van Winkle came to work today, too, to intern for us.
Is your mother. You need to go down there in Florida and put your mother straight and say, listen, bitch, you Bible-banging bitch, I'm fucking gay, and you need to fucking deal with it.
He's not, though.
You have a gay son.
He's not gay.
I am gay.
You're not gay, Fuss.
Whatever. Well, you know, maybe then you'll get laid if you just... come out to your mother and just say either you accept me or you don't, you Bible-banging bitch.
You keep repeating the Bible-banging thing over
and
over.
Well, people in my family that are part of that whole church crap, that they join churches that just justify their sick political ideology.
Mm.
And it's sick.
I've joined a church, and it's actually been very fun.
What church is that?
A satanic church.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Last night, we killed a kid.
Human sacrifice, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Should you be making this on the air? That sounds like a fucking crime, murdering.
Not if it's done for religious purposes. I mean, we used all the body.
Oh, okay.
No, that doesn't make it better.
No, if there's no remains.
It gets better.
You can't. You killed a child.
Do, do, do. Kenny, you're on the Ron Fez Show. Go ahead, Kenny.
Hey, so let me get this straight, Ronnie B. Fez has a problem with someone being quiet and or possibly sleeping during an interview when he sleeps through the entire show normally, correct?
Sleeps with his eyes open. And, like, there's so many things I want to talk about on the show today, but if I get into them, I know the Fez is going to disappear, and then that's going to leave you vulnerable to the callers when they're going to do the weird Fez go.
What happened? Popcorn's out here.
What happened?
Man, Fez.
What did you say?
Man, Fez.
Hey, did you get me any kind of wrapping paper? I got some nice presents.
Oh.
For Dave.
Oh, that's exciting for Dave.
Yeah. It's great for Dave. Travis, you're on the Ron Fez Show.
Hey, I want to just prove how, you know, kind of backhanded Fez is going to be. If you look up the Jezelnik offensive with Jim Norton, it's about bullying. Let's see how pissed off he gets, because it's the exact same thing he's doing today.
Fez used to do live reads for that. Have you ever once watched the show?
No, I haven't seen it.
And yet you do the live reads?
Yeah.
You don't view that as a lie?
No, because I'm sure it's a very, very funny show.
How are you sure?
Anthony Jeselnik's a funny person, so I'm assuming it's a funny show on Comedy Central.
What are some of his jokes that you think that he's so funny about?
I can't think of any offhand, but I've seen some on the roast.
Some on the roast?
Yeah, on the Comedy Central roast.
So that's all you know about him is the roast.
There's
but you do live reads. It doesn't even occur to you to do some prep or even realize if you're saying to the people whether it's true or not? Doesn't matter?
No, I think it matters.
But then you don't do it.
No, I did not do that. I hadn't seen that show.
Hmm. That's why you sounded like you never saw the show when you were doing the live reads. But you did fill the 60 seconds. And that's the important thing, right?
Well, that's, I guess, one of the things that they need.
Who's they?
The sponsor and the sales.
To fill your 60 seconds.
Yeah, as part of that.
That'd be great. We can say that at your funeral. He gave you the absolute minimum. He provided 60 seconds for every 60 seconds paid.
Rest.
Did he take the time to watch a half-hour program? One that Jim Norton actually even appeared on? No. But he did read the copy. He did read the copy. What are you checking on there? Just pictures of yourself?
No. This thing kind of snagged.
Your ID broke?
Let me see it.
It didn't break. It's about to, though. Looks like the it's about to get snagged.
Yeah, don't.
Hand it over. Come on.
I will get you another one of these because you don't want to lose this because it becomes a pain in the ass.
Yeah, I just go down to.
Don't worry.
What's her face, right?
Yeah, what's her face? She'll take care of it.
Thank you.
I wonder if she would be. She would hate that nickname. What's her face?
Yeah, what's her face? Yeah, her? Yeah. First thing to write to it a bunch of times.
Jim Scranton, you're on the Run of Fest show.
Yeah, hey, Popcorn Song, $1 million today, baby. Way to go with the stick. Managing the stick today. Hey, I just wanted to make mention of a few parallels between Popcorn's behavior and Fez's actual behavior.
Hmm.
And if you look hard enough, you could actually, everything that Fez hates about Popcorn, if you just substituted Popcorn's name with Fez's name, you would get Fez's entire activity. So, in other words, Fez takes drugs during the show. Fez falls asleep during the show.
Maybe this is like Fight Club, and there is no Popcorn.
Oh, my God.
And Fez is going to go flying around, and then finally find out there's never been a Popcorn or a Jeselnik. That all this took place on the operating table for Fez's first heart attack. And he's been caught in a whirlpool of weirdness. Hey, do we need to break?
Yeah.
All right, we'll break and come back and wrap this one up. It's a Run of Fez show.
Enjoying the Ron and Fez show on SiriusXM's Opie and Anthony channel. More in moments.
It's the music that we choose. 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 It's the music that we choose.
The world is spinning super. I'm fine that I get shoes to keep myself tethered to the days I tried to lose. My mama said to slow down, you must make your own shoes. stop dancing to the music. I've got Gorillaz in a happy mood. Keep my groove on.
It's Ron and Fez show. Gorillaz doing a thing. It is Ron and Fez show on a Wednesday.
It's a Wednesday. Wednesday.
I was just looking over stuff for tomorrow. All kinds of people stopping by him.
Yeah, it's packed.
It's packed for Thursday. I'm gonna write a song on the Gorillaz. I just got a thing sent to me that says, Mr. B, I was at the John Irving interview. You said it was a once-in-a-lifetime experience. We shook hands afterwards, and you commented that was like being with the room with Faulkner, and I agreed. But I sat in the back row next to Whatley. He was passing gas and ended up touching my thigh. I never want to relive this. Considering he's beating the kid up, I thought you might want to know and perhaps reconsider Fez sitting with the audience.
Jesus. Passing gas is worse than falling
asleep. And who's that from?
That was from JP.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, like I would want to touch JP's thigh.
Did you pass gas, though?
No.
Why would he make that up?
You even admit it back then when we used to look around the room a little bit. That was you because you were going through meds.
Oh, yeah, yeah. But I know I didn't do it during John Irving.
I know you did it in that studio during a mass before, though.
That has happened, yes. That was.
Why wouldn't you get up and excuse yourself and take your ass outside, though? See, everybody...
That could end up releasing more.
Yeah, outside, not inside. See, everybody makes mistakes, and that's what Fez has been trying to tell you today. Do you feel like you've learned anything from Fez?
Yeah.
You know? What have you learned?
You know, his, when he wants to, you know, he can really command the mic, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like yesterday, the wrestling story.
Oh, yeah.
He was grabbing the mic by the balls, you know? And
he has the ability, he just doesn't always go for it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And he feels insecure about being, complimented. And I think that's what stops him from doing more cool stuff.
You see, the kid understands you, Fez.
Mm-hmm.
It's surprising, actually. He has insight. Popcorn does, you know, he sees things and knows what's happening around him.
He does.
And I just learned during the commercial break that I guess him sleeping during the en masse was a bigger spectacle than I even realized after hearing about it.
Why is that?
Because I was here, I had to hear from E-Rock. Who wanted to see the Alan Alda unmasked, and he was in the booth. He said, yeah, we all saw him nodding off and sleeping through it, through the window.
I didn't sleep through it. I heard every word.
Just kept your eyes closed.
Once in a while, I did have to close my eyes.
That's all. You got a headache.
Yeah. And I got
you feel
some...
validation now that E-Rock has backed you up?
Oh, I believed it from the beginning, but now I'm realizing that I guess it was even more of something going on behind my back than I realized.
Do you feel like he was just trying to do that to you, Fez?
No, I think he just disrespects everything about this place.
Popcorn's not disrespectful. He may be misguided, but he had no intention.
You going to have him in the audience for the next Unmasked?
He was put in... as a last-second replacement.
Are you blaming Chris on this, though?
It's my fault.
No. Chris says the kid's wonderful. So I guess he did a great job in the audience today.
I'm not saying he's wonderful. I'm saying that he's misguided. Yes, I do see the audience. Yes, that's my job.
So it's okay if your intern is snoring through one.
Anyone hear a snore? Did anyone announce they heard snoring?
No.
No. Because he wasn't sleeping. He was just closing his eyes.
Literally, like this.
That's not what anyone has seen.
You're exaggerating, but you were just closing your eyes.
No, that's what I was doing.
He kept watching your head get lower and lower and lower till it was almost in your lap.
Dude, you were in my eye line, and I could see. I felt like a priest during a fucking Sunday mass.
I was leaning back, so there's no way I could be leaning forward.
Hmm.
He had a migraine.
So you think the kid's doing okay?
Yes, yes. Jesus Christ. Since coming back from vacation, he has improved tenfold.
Okay, so can I hear no more bitching about how he doesn't know how to use a printer?
When's the last time it happened? No one's bitched more about printers than you, Fez. You've had meltdowns in the morning because printers don't work. Fucking meltdowns.
You don't bitch about the printer, you bitch about him.
When's the last time I bitched about him and printing? This is what you keep bringing up. So when's the last time I did it?
I think it was, it's hard to remember because he's rarely here.
That was like the first week.
I know anytime he hands you anything, the papers go flying on the desk.
Yeah, because
and,
I put
and it here. Right. What the fuck?
When's the last time that happened? When I've had him been printing things out, they've been fine lately.
I think I saw it just last week.
What bio or what was they printed out for?
I have no idea. All I know is you're screaming in there about him. But today,
I'm screaming in here.
But today
I scream
he's
outside.
An angel. That's all right. You're afraid of him. I understand.
I'm afraid of him? Okay.
I guess so. I don't know why you're sticking up for him.
Because he's my intern and I'm his fucking mentor. And I have to be responsible for him. That's why I'm sticking up for him. And I'm trying to teach him and fucking show him how to do this shit.
I'm just bringing up all the mistakes.
And you're screaming at him like a maniac.
I'm bringing up all
Seems
the
like
things
you got less
you...
of a problem with him than you do with Chris Stanley. You're just taking it off on the kid. Seems like you're being unhappy in the office has to do with Chris Stanley.
No, my...
I'll work at the intern stations.
Shit's getting real.
My unhappiness is that Chris apparently doesn't... It's just going to brush off this sleeping during an unmasked thing. As it being the kid's personal charm.
A, he is very charming. I'll give him that. B... He wasn't sleeping. He had closed his eyes for a little bit.
Ron said he was sleeping. E-Rock said he was sleeping.
I don't believe it.
I made eye contact with those guys. I was looking in the booth. Jim Norton was in there, right?
So you feel like that?
No, I can't defend myself, so what's the, you know?
No one said you were sleeping for the full 65 minutes. Fez... Does it feel like you and Chris Stanley can't share an office anymore?
That's what it's beginning to feel like, because I feel like I came in here today defending Chris and Pips.
Wait, what?
And got attacked.
I don't see that you defended anybody.
By finally saying the things that they say in the office out loud.
It hasn't happened in a while. Now, when he first started, there was confusion and anger. But things have changed. Things literally have changed. He is better than when we first came in here.
He was asleep during an interview as part of the studio audience. How is that getting better? That was today.
He's gotten better. He was fucking closed his eyes for part of an interview. That doesn't speak for his entire internship or his entire being. People get headaches and people get sick. There's extenuating circumstances. The kid's gotten better since he started the show.
And that doesn't mean I wasn't listening.
Well, I'll say this, Fez. You sure shut your pie hole when Chris Stanley jumps into it. You don't feel as fucking froggy as you were with that poor kid. Here's Eric. You're on the Run a Fez show.
A couple months ago, you had a video on the iBang of a guy firing a kid in his business. And at that point in time, Fez was on the kid's side saying that the guy should mentor the kid and give him a second chance.
Right.
And maybe he could make his life better. And right here, Fez is in the same position with Popcorn here to mentor him and give him a chance and make his life better. Just like what he was telling the kid in the video, but he's not even trying any of that.
Why isn't he trying? That's all I want to know. He says everybody else should try and give people a second chance, but he's not willing to.
Well, that's the consistency factor that he struggles with. Let's go over here to Travis. You're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, Sleeping Beauty, do me a favor. I got some advice for you. Hey, look at Fez. Are you looking at him in the eye?
Look at Fez.
Yes.
Oh, he dozed off. Go ahead.
Okay, now look at Fez and repeat after me. Fez, go fuck yourself.
Fez, go fuck yourself.
Fuck you, Christ. You little fucking bitch.
You saw that he was just doing the bit with the guy. Now, why are you getting strong with him? I know you didn't get strong with Chris Stanley.
I told Chris Stanley everything I was thinking.
You were very polite and subdued and submissive when Chris Stanley was fucking lighting you up with this kid. All of a sudden, you're ready to throw down.
I can't believe Chris Stanley's serious about letting that kid in another unmasked audience. That he believes the bullshit.
The kid didn't belong in one. Fucking Otto canceled. The kid took the seat. That's why he was there.
I'd improvise.
He improvised. It's not like the kid got some special treatment. He was going to watch from the booth. Where if he needed to, he could have laid down and slept. Or, as you like to do, Fez, fart into your pants. Shannon, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hi, guys. I just want to bring it to Fez's attention that even when he's awake, he contributes lips and popcorn, and he gets paid.
Nice. Go hang out at a fertilizer plant in Texas.
Oh, my God.
Jesus. You stink worse than that, Fez. Thanks, Ron. Bye, guys.
Wow. Anti-fertilizer victims. I never expected that.
Those are dozens.
Andrew, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Yeah, how you doing? Popcorn may not be a perfect person, but Fez is acting like a real witch, and somebody should put him in his place. He's a real faggot.
Well, I don't like to use that word, but Chris Stanley chilled everything out, didn't he? You got a cooler here. You just got to use some popcorn. If you're getting harassed, just go to your mentor, Chris Stanley. And apparently everything will get real quiet real fast around here.
He will be screaming about popcorn again by the end of the working day.
Oh, definitely not.
Yeah, but he won't have to take your abuse because it looks like the cooler showed up.
Everybody just calm down, okay? It's going to be fine.
You should actually just walk around that office with a rubber mallet.
Hey.
Well, I don't often stay after with you guys, but I did find out something today. Who the office daddy is? Chris Stanley.
I don't think so, because for some reason he's terrified of this intern.
Why would I be terrified of fucking popcorn?
Because you haven't told the truth about him at all today.
I've told that before the fucking vacation, he was fucking not good, and he missed days, but he hasn't missed a day since. And he's been fucking doing the things I've told him to do.
You told him to sleep during an unmasked?
Yes, Fez.
Fucking come up again because of the redundancy. Now I wish I never even would have said it. And I can't believe that adult men sit around and talk about fucking printers the way you guys do. What are you upset about now, Pop?
No, I could have just used another printer.
I don't care about that. That's the end
of the story.
Seriously, I feel like I'm in a fucking steno pool, the way you guys talk about fucking printers.
You see, sometimes I run out of paper, sometimes
I feel like I'm with the girls and fucking Mad Men. Seriously.
I got to shift in the switchboard later.
Here's Cigars and Scotch.
I think Popcorn would be more confident and a better intern if he had his own walk-on music. How about Enter Sandman?
Come on, Cigar. Come on, man.
We never found the walk-on music in a while. Oh, you got to read off that name from earlier, too. We got a winner.
Yes, we have a winner. That would be @eombre. @eombre. Gets the signed Tom Folsom Hopper book.
Eombre!
¿Qué pasó, papa?
You know all that stuff.
I know, Lil. He's a big winner.
Jack, you're on the Ron and Fez show. Jack in Waco.
It is an honor.
honor to be on the Ron and Fez show. Excuse me, the Ron and Centaur show. I mean, it's not like Fez contributes at all. However,
learning how to say Centaur.
That is how can you sit there and talk about a tragedy in Waco and refer to that? Hope someone is in that tragedy. People died. I mean, I'm not going to use any slurs. You are funny at times. Man, you've got to take a step back.
That did cross the line. I mean, in the too soon thing, Fez.
I want to call you so many times to contribute, but to call it a miss, I mean, that is heartless. Put it aside, man. Reevaluate it. People died.
All right, peace.
Bye.
Keith, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, Ronnie, I just have a question. Does management ever say, like, hey, quit fucking with the interns? They're not even getting paid?
No. No one ever brings it up, do they?
No.
And your internship is going pretty good overall, right?
I don't know.
Other than, like, if you got outside of this Fez problem that you've been having, how's your internship been?
I mean, I love it, you know?
Well, we love having you here.
Oh, it's great.
They do.
And the only mark against him in the midterm evaluation was his lateness and missing days. Everything else was fine. And that's improved considerably.
Now, why'd you mark him down on that, Chris? He probably had a headache.
Give me a fucking break.
That does sound like you, the way you talk, though.
Fuck that.
Jeez. Poor guy. Why would you mark him down on that?
Do you want to attack him some more, or so you're just attacking me now?
No, I thought he was doing everything perfect.
I fucking have brought this up multiple times. He fucking had bad lateness beforehand, now it's fine. I fucking put him in an audience, and he closed his eyes. That's the whole fucking thing.
I said I wouldn't bring it up again, but you know he didn't just close his eyes.
I know he just closed his eyes.
Alright, so, Ron, you were wrong. E-Rock, you were wrong.
So then how was I laughing? I was sleep laughing? You had to have heard me laughing.
I didn't hear you.
I would love the fact that if you wouldn't get stuck in a rut and going back to the same stuff, there was other things. I know we're almost at the end of the show. Or when he just jumped up like that, you could have met it. Here's Dan. Dan, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, Ronnie B. I got a chance to watch that Watertown video.
Yeah.
And they're looking for one specific kid, yet they marched out how many people out of that clown car house, like you said. They got frisked at the bottom of the stairs. Then they went about a block and got frisked again. I find that extremely disturbing. I want to see what you think.
No, I said the exact same thing, and I think the country should be in a huge debate on what happened up in Boston and what we want to do in the future. I got an email from a guy last night from Boston who said I was being intellectually dishonest and I would react differently whether it was in New York. But when I'm in New York and they do this on UN weeks and you see the city's military in the streets, it's not a very comfortable thing. I think we ought to watch out for it. I think we ought to be very, very fucking careful with it. Let's go over here to Pete. You're on the Ron and Fez show.
Buddies.
Yeah.
New nickname for Popcorn ought to be Spider. I mean, Fez busts in his balls and he goes, tells him to fuck himself. Good for you, kid. Don't take no shit off nobody.
Did that feel good when you finally got a chance to say that?
I didn't understand him at
well,
all.
When you I let heard... the caller talk you into telling Fez to go fuck himself.
Oh. No, it didn't make me feel any better.
How did you feel when your mentor came to your defense and chilled Fez out and put him in a whole new place?
Appreciated.
That's the mentor.
Were you surprised Pips didn't do it for you, too?
Yeah, heartbroken.
Pips, is there any reason why you refused to jump in?
Yeah, it reminds me when I was 2 years old and my parents were fighting before they got divorced. I do not want to get in the middle again.
Because then it'll be his fault, you know.
It was his fault.
Own it.
It was his fault when he was two. I mean, he is the one who broke his folks up.
He took up all their time.
Yeah, and money. I mean, they had a lot happening before he came and wasted their time and money. All right, here's Bobby. You're on the Run and Fez show.
Hey, good afternoon. Hey, Fez, how many times did you walk off the show yesterday?
I believe it was 3.
Okay, did you think you were contributing?
We were talking about me walking off, so in a way, yes.
How is that? If you're supposed to be a co-host of the show, why are you walking off of the show?
Oh, I was going to make sure that...
That's the end of my show. Donk.
That show starts right now.
Ooh, 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 ooh. I ain't happy. I'm feeling glad I got sunshine.